All right, we're live. Guys, we got a fun show today. We got Luke Alexander on, and we are excited to bring this episode to you. There's going to be live people in the chat. We're streaming. We're now streamers. There's going to be... Oh, I can get some feedback there.
Shit. There we go. Yeah, I had to close out the YouTube.
Okay. So we're going to tackle a lot today. We're going to tackle Way of the Modern Man. We're going to tackle... the T word that just got banned and is now as synonymously, you can't use it like the C word. We're going to talk about why relationships are the new flex. We're going to talk about a whole lot of things in between, the spiritual warfare that's going on right now and how you can step up, how we're stepping up. So Luke, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Let's start here. What was this loser saying to us on Twitter? He was trying to make an argument that basically the argument that I read was that like trust fund babies have an advantage or something like that, which is funny because I responded to him and I was like, dude, the most popular people on the internet or the most successful entrepreneurs that I know are all like they all had like fathers that beat them or like literally.
Yeah. Yeah, you're fucking spot on with me and a lot of people we know. So yeah, it's just people trying to cope. Like I replied to him, I think. And I said, yeah, you're coping for not being where you want to be and yeah. Stop hating success.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny. I think he made a tweet. I don't know where it is in the thread. But he said something like he made some thread. Did you see the one where he made the thread of like Bill Gates or whoever it was?
Yeah. And Bezos and everybody.
Yeah. Like, I guess they were born with an advantage, but I don't know. I like there's equally as many examples of extremely successful entrepreneurs that started with absolutely nothing.
Yeah. It's an advantage either way. Like if you're Jeff Bezos and your parents gave you a $250,000 loan, cool. But what he turned that into, like 99.999% of people could not do what he has done. So is it unimpressive because he had a little bit of help? No. Is it an advantage? Yes. But it's also an advantage to be like I know you're friends with E-Man as well. Like us, we have a massive advantage because of what we went through as kids, you know? That's something you can't buy, is that like intangible hunger and mental toughness and everything.
Dude, yeah. Like the psychopathy that guys like you have built into you to like, I have to take care of my mom. I have to, you know, do this. It's like, that is a character trait that I'm envious of. My situation was a little bit different. I haven't talked too much about it publicly, but like, you know, I love my parents. I was never like abused by my parents, but as much as I love them, like my mom's a painter, my dad's a photographer. I grew up with probably the worst beliefs around money that you could have.
Yeah.
Like money is evil. There were always arguments and fights about money in my house. And so I was just programmed with like, you know, scarce money is scarce, and I've had to like I'm still working to rewire all of those things that I learned growing up.
You know, I was about to say, I bet it took you some time to learn, unlearn those beliefs.
I'm still learning. It's, you know, when money is such a massive tree of beliefs that you have to like dissect each part of it and why you can't figure out a certain part of that life that part of money for you. So. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, the thing is, you can like spin this around so many different ways, and like reality is just a collection of present moments in which you can look at the benefits or the drawbacks of each side. And so, you know, for someone like you, it was a massive, and I actually don't know your full story, but I watched the Way of the Modern Man or Which Way Modern Man video, and I heard mention it. Mm-hmm. Do you mind sharing a little bit about like your background?
Yeah, I can give you like a high level, because we watch these a lot, and it's annoying when someone talks like, oh, my whole life story. So I'm from a super small town, grew up extremely poor, didn't have internet until I moved to college, like ever. So everyone that had like phones and internet and YouTube and games and all this stuff, I did not have. I was like in the woods like all the time. Had similar to you, like no belief about money. I didn't know what an entrepreneur was until I was 18 years old. So like the thought of any of that was just non-existent. Really abusive dad. Like you've said, which is pretty funny, like entrepreneurs, their dads beat them. Like, yeah, that was me and my brother. And yeah, so just really shitty situation, decided I'm done with this. I have to get out or we're going to be stuck in this forever. And I don't want to deal with that. So I moved away to college just to get internet access, went to college for a semester and a half and dropped out and said, fuck this. Even if I graduate, what am I going to make? Like $100,000 a year. I can't help us on that. Right. I've got to like go big or it's not even worth living. So decided to say fuck school and go as big as we could. And fast forward a couple of years and now I'm in Miami and we're doing what we're doing. So that's the high level.
Got it. Yeah. We don't have to go too much into it. I'm sure your viewers already know that.
Yep.
But yeah, dude, I mean like the smart people just take their background story and whatever shit they went through and they turn it into motivation or they turn it into a drawback or they turn it into a benefit rather than like a cope. And our
that's why, dude, honestly, it's an advantage because like you put a tweet out and I tweeted something similar like a week ago. You said something about entrepreneurship being like the best sport in the world. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Which is why this even started. And it is because no matter my background, no matter your background, one of us will win and it's fair because it's whoever does the best there. Like maybe you have advantages, right? If someone starts with money, but at the same time, you can look at someone like myself or whoever else, you have intangible stuff that you can't buy by going through that. And it's kind of a massive advantage because no one willingly puts themselves through pain. Like when you go to lift at the gym, like you get bigger muscles because you endure pain. But imagine you were forced to do that for the first 18 years of your life and you have no alternative. If you get through it, you're going to be way better off than the people who like have to choose to go put themselves in pain because it's not the state that you're naturally in. Does that make sense? So
yeah, absolutely.
Whether it's an advantage or not, like there's always advantages and disadvantages in any situation. So I think it's cope again. Like entrepreneurship is the most fair game in the world. Like if you win, you win. There are no rules. You get to do whatever you want.
Absolutely. Yeah. Let's expand on that a little bit more. Like, I'd heard that quote before. I didn't know where I heard it. Someone said it, Dan Locke originally said it, but the moment I tweeted it, it just kind of clicked for me because I was just thinking about my company and myself and realizing that, and you know, who also talks about it a lot is E-Man. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, yeah, I mean, entrepreneurship, it's a sport. It's like, what are we all doing? We're all doing what we had to do when we played high school sports or college sports or whatever. Like we're sleep optimizing. We're training to make sure that we can achieve optimal focus. We're literally leading a team of other guys that we or other men and women that we would hope are taking care of their health and fitness so they can show up and basically focus for longer hours than anybody else. We're like competing against people in the same niche. So it's absolutely a competition. And it's interesting. I think one of the reasons, and what we'll talk about a lot on this conversation here with the spiritual warfare stuff, I think one of the reasons entrepreneurs like you and me and Iman talk about the spiritual warfare and we can see through, you know, the C word bullshit propaganda. We can see through the tape band propaganda. The reason we're able to see that as entrepreneurs is because we deploy the same tactics for our team in order to win our game, which is basically try to get more clients and change more people's lives. And so when like, you know, when the average person or not average person, but when someone who isn't an entrepreneur, who isn't learning about, you know, why social proof is important and why creating authority is important. Like, I look at the whole CNN, Fox News, like all of that as just like really good marketing for a business. It's like they read, whoever designed the whole system read Influence by Robert Cialdini and was like, oh, if you put people in a suit at a desk, people will believe what they say.
Yeah.
And that's all they did, you know?
No, the 100%.
The same way that like you and I, like right now, you know, I have the cool view in the background and I have the nice microphone and you have the nice microphone. It's just authority bias, you know? And there's so many other biases that come into play that the news is just good at, but then, and then Yeah, it's just like
it's the same game. Just they have a different motive. We're kind of doing it obviously to make money, and our own source of power. But they are playing to have ultimate power, which we can't really play that game yet. If we ever wanted to, but their outcomes are just larger than ours.
It's like we go through these online courses that teach us how to improve our offers, right? And like and how to motivate people to take action. Like what I do is I help guys improve and grow their social life and social circle and improve their relationships. And one of the ways I do that is like fear marketing, right? I'm like essentially like hitting on the fact of like, do you want to be alone? No, you don't, right? The news, Pfizer, Moderna, you know, these large companies that are generating millions of dollars.
They're oh my doing God, this- you're going to die. Your whole family's going to die. You have to get this stabbed. Yeah. Everyone's going to die.
Yeah. And they're just, it's just so obvious to guys like you and me.
Yeah. And it is. And people don't understand money will never understand that, because the people, like, it's obviously, you know, this, like, I don't have to tell you, but the pharmaceutical companies, the people making the laws and legislation have a vested interest in those companies. So that's why it all takes place. If there was no vested interest, they'd be like, yeah, let's not do this to the people. But there is. It's, oh, no, we're going to benefit a lot from this. So like people that don't understand money and they don't understand like any of that, they're just going to be blind to it. And oh, you're a conspiracy theorist.
Yeah. Yeah, because they just seriously, they don't understand how their mind is influenced by things, and they're NPCs. Like they are asleep at the wheel.
And NPCs are real, dude.
It's so real. And entrepreneurship is a sport that wakes you up, because if you aren't good at it, you lose. And
it's do or die. It's like I went to an MMA fight with my girl the other day. My coach that trains me was fighting. And she's never seen MMA before. And dude, this is such a good example. She was like, how do they win? And I was like, well, picture it like this. Those guys are in the cage trying to kill each other. If there is no ref, somebody dies. Like if this was a real world fight, someone would die. And that's the same analogy as business. It's like there are no rules, except for maybe we have government bodies and legislation, whatever. So like kind of there are a little bit of rules. But there's no rules that say I can't go post whatever I want to post to compete with you. Who's competing with me, you're going to post whatever you want to post or do whatever you want to do, launch whatever offer you want. It's literally war in a civilized fashion. And it's a great equalizer. It doesn't matter where you start, where you finish, where you come from, who you are, what color you are, it doesn't matter. And people, especially our modern world, I'm sure we'll talk about this too, like the social justice stuff and political correctness and everything, they can't fathom that because they don't want to take responsibility for their own actions. Or their own, like the consequences of their own actions. Like you can't fathom something like entrepreneurship or capitalism if, oh, it's because I'm this color or I'm this creed or religion. No, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, there's no rules. That's a great way to put it. Yeah, I mean, I think one thing we were going to talk about today is a T word. Yeah. The AT word, which the reason we're referencing that is because we were going to talk about Mr. T, the top letter before H.
AI is going to be censoring everything, so you got to be careful how you say it.
Yeah, AI is ridiculous. I'm actually even debating on like pulling up a screenshot, but I think everyone knows who we're talking about.
Yeah, everyone knows. I wouldn't pull it up because the AI will recognize faces and stuff, which is really scary. But people know,
right? But what I wanted to ask you about, because this is something that's been on my mind, is what do you think his next move is? I personally think he knew exactly what was going to happen to him. Mm-hmm. I think he knew he was going to get canceled. I can kind of just tell by the way he's playing it. And I like that Tate final method, T final message video. I'm pretty sure he knew he was going to do that for quite a while. And I don't know if you heard him say, like, I have a 3-part plan. This is only part one. Part two is on the way.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on that? Or do you think he genuinely was just eliminated?
No, they knew. He's a very intelligent guy. So I've actually known him since 2019. Like before he blew up, I have a video of it. He challenged me to a fist fight with my brother and I, because we said something like disrespectful on Twitter. And then we ended up like right before he blew up, he messaged me and was like, hey, G, like I see your stuff or something. It's time to get in the war room. So like I kind of know, like I've known of him for a while. He's very intelligent, obviously.
Are you in the war room?
I'm not.
Okay.
No, I was going to join, but I just never did for whatever reason. I think they knew it was coming. And I think step one was take over social media. Step two is make your own social media. Because what is more powerful than taking over other people's platforms? Like TikTok, they obviously took it over. Like faces everywhere. It's owning your own platform and owning rights to your own platform. So I think that's why they pushed the... It's Rumble, right? Rumble is the new...
Like, is that his or is that just the one that...
Well, it's not his, but what better way to build massive wealth than be the most popular person in the world, get banned from this social media, and then get a vested interest in this decentralized platform?
Right.
There is no better plan in my eyes to make billions of dollars than to do that. Because everyone like us and Sneeko, I've seen Sneeko just got his Twitter deleted. He just got a strike on YouTube. Literally everybody that speaks their mind. One of my TikTok accounts got deleted because I posted a clip of that the Mike Malak video. It just got deleted for hateful rhetoric is what they called it. So I think part two is that own the platform.
It's Atlas Shrugged, but of the internet.
Yeah.
So the T word is John Gull. And I wonder if part two is like, hey, we're starting. Actually, you know what's funny? I got a text message from a random number. And I know some guys that are, I know like the HU professors and some guys that are personal friends of Mr. T. Mr. T. And I got a text and it was like, we're starting a decentralized web platform and we're recruiting. Are you interested? And I sent it to the guys that know Mr. T and they said they had no idea what it was. They thought it was spam, but yeah. It does make perfect sense. And I would not be surprised at all if he's planning to do that and basically planning to slowly take all of the most intelligent people off the internet who want to speak their mind and just bring them to this new platform and basically say, hey, if you want to find us, we're not going to be on Instagram anymore. We're not going to be on YouTube. We're only going to be here.
Yeah.
And slowly.
It's the probably best way to make like ridiculous amounts of money and keep power that you could possibly think of. It's a chess move because there are already like decentralized platforms like Truth Social. I think Trump started Parler. I heard about a while ago, Gitter, Rumble, whatever. One of them is going to come out as like a clear winner. And some of the most valuable companies in the world are these social media tech companies, Instagram, Facebook, Meta, whatever. So if you're the clear winner that comes out and you're the most famous person in the world and you're like, hey, you guys want to see my stuff? It's happening here. Like you just said, that's such a big money move. Like that's such a big move. And they are public because I looked because I wanted to buy stock in Rumble. but they went public in like a SPAC. So there's no... I don't think it's a single stock. It's like one of those merger group things. But I think that's phase two. Phase three, I don't know, dude. I don't know how ambitious they want to be.
What if phase three is, I don't know, what did John Galt do? What if phase three is cancel Zuckerberg or something? All his war room guys just show up and just eliminate the CEOs and like...
Yeah, but that is like... That's war, like actual war. I don't think they would let that happen because then people like bad things actually happen.
Yeah. Well, the issue is there's a couple things that I hadn't previously thought about when I was listening to that clip that I sent you. There was parts of it that I didn't send you afterward. It was Dan Fleischman talking about it, and they were saying how, or Dan Fleischman was saying how, of course Rumble is popping right now because you know. Sort of, you know, it's the height of Mr. T you know, wanting to promote it. But these algorithms of these giant companies, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, Twitter probably is the least bad of all of them. But they're all going to censor the word Rumble because they don't want people leaving their platforms. So it's going to be difficult. So it's going to be very interesting to see how he tries to do it when Google and Meta are basically censoring everything that he's trying to do and they have seemingly so much more power.
I think their days are numbered, to be honest, because people like us are waking up. And they've already, you don't go backwards in censorship. Like once you go over that line of, okay, if you don't agree with what we say, we're going to remove you. They won't ever revert back. It's like 9/11, you didn't have airport security and TSA and everything. And then it happened. We didn't go back. The mask wearing, I don't think we're going to go back, you know, like it stays how it is.
The line keeps getting further and further.
Yeah. So I think these platforms have already shot themselves in the foot. Advertisers won't be putting money there. And as soon as Rumble can put out a comparable product to something like YouTube or whatever, that's such a big money play, dude. All the advertisers will want to move over. You imagine a Facebook, like you've probably run Facebook ads and YouTube ads before. Yeah. Imagine a Facebook that is not as hardcore as your ad account just getting banned for the wrong things. They will print money out of thin air.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if I'm Mr. T and I'm like, okay, media is power, obviously, in our world. Narrative is power. Perception is power. I want to own that thing. I want a piece of that thing. And I have all the power and I have all the money. That's exactly what I would do.
Another perspective that I hadn't thought of about why another reason why Mr. T won't be coming back into being unbanned is, and this is what Dan Fleischman was saying, imagine a boardroom meeting with Meta's top employees, YouTube's top employees, Google, and it's their top employees. And there's going to be some women in that room who feel very strongly. How is anyone in that room going to convince those women to bring this man back? It's not going to happen.
No, there's no chance. I heard it happen because one of the execs or whatever was some lady. I saw a picture of her and she was like furious, like super liberal, super feminist.
It was type just
of
Susan.
Maybe. I don't know. But a Karen, super, right. Super left. And if you're that person, you kind of have power. It's like, okay, I don't like this guy. Let's just take him off. That's ridiculous. I haven't heard that term. And did really? You see, oh, actually, crazy. I saw this yesterday, bro. There is like a bombshell, whatever, dropping. The Biden administration has been meeting like very consistently with Facebook to literally say, hey, we want to censor this month. And there's proof of it. I don't know how legit it is, but I skimmed through it briefly and it looked pretty real. But obviously, it's going to get shadowed and censored.
It's a war, man. It's an all-out war.
And people don't realize that. And it's the worst kind of war because it's not a war of like, okay, the strong will win or the dangerous will win. It's like the little, like Tate, I mean, fuck, Mr. T talked about it all the time. Like the little like nerdy guys that run Facebook, they have power now. And how are you going to fight that war? We can't just go take their office. You can't do that. Like you simply can't. So it's a completely different kind of game. Honestly, this war is harder to fight than the others.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very, very interesting. I think another thing that's very interesting is the level of brainwashing that you can observe from people discussing this topic and discussing Mr. T. Like, I don't know if it's come up at the dinner table with you at all ever. But it's come up a couple times in situations I've been in, and it's just like, it's amazing how much people will defend, and Mr. T talked about it, how much people will defend the Matrix, you know, and like the system of control that they're in.
It's, and you know who is like really blew my mind of how deeply brainwashed they are is women our age. Like, I love women. Like, I'm not a hater of whatever, like, or the red pill shit, but bro. Oh my God, 95%, probably more, of girls I know our age got the jab and they didn't even research it. They're like, oh no, it's fine. They say it's fine. I'm just going to do it. Can't tell you what mRNA is. Can't tell you how it's different than a normal one. They're all in birth control. Like, we could go on a list. Like, this will be the whole podcast if we talk about it, but they are so brainwashed that it's absurd. And I don't know how they got hit so hard. Because we are a little bit less. But like,
no, the reason is because it's really simple. It is completely simple. It is because, and this is probably the most hated thing that I would ever say and the most controversial thing that I will ever say. But part of the reason I'm dating my current girlfriend is because she wouldn't be offended by this, but the vast majority of people will be offended by this, is that when, I mean, anyone who has a girlfriend knows she hates it when you ask her to make a decision. Every woman hates it when the man is trying to make them choose where to go to dinner or what she should wear tonight. Like, how many times have you been getting ready for dinner and your girl's like, which dress should I wear?
Every time.
And then you go, I don't know, you look great in both. And she goes, just pick for me. Women don't like to make decisions. It's difficult. They don't enjoy it. They want the man to make a decision. They like it. And if you extrapolate that out further, you know, it's maybe a big conclusion to come to, but the reason, like part of the reason women are more likely to, for example, get a jab or get X, Y, and Z is because they have been programmed by the mass media marketing machine that tells people what to do and that is using these marketing tactics. Whereas guys like you and me and other guys who would, you know, who would have been, you know, whatever, the captain of their sports team in high school and whatnot, we don't like being told what to do by anybody.
Not at all.
So we are, and that's why we do what we do. So, I mean, to me, that's the easiest explanation. It's just like,
yeah, they're much more agreeable. They want to be led more so.
They want to be led. They want to be told what to do. They just do. Yeah. You cannot argue with that. I mean,
it probably is our fault too.
And here's the thing. They're not weak because of it. That's not a weak trait. That's just
it's just their nature.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's probably a lot of it is probably the like, obviously men too. Like, go 100 years back, women listened to their husbands, and like if the government said something to the family would be like up to the husband of what they want to do. If the husband was like, "Yeah, this is stupid. We're not doing this," it wouldn't happen. But now that doesn't happen. It's like all the feminism, everything, like you just said. There really is no, like, in a relationship dynamic, there is no, like, masculine, like, decision maker, at least not commonly, you know? So, yeah, that makes perfect sense.
Yeah, you can't, these days, you can't say what I just said, or else people get very upset. And here's the thing, I'm open to a debate, but I don't know how you can debate what I just said. I mean, and again, like, it doesn't mean that women are weaker. It absolutely doesn't. It's just, that's just female nature, and it makes sense through evolution, too. You know,
yeah.
We can have the debate of like, you know, of course there are some women who are stronger than men and there's some men that are small and weak and can't fend for themselves. But the reason we evolved this way, obviously, is because men are biologically, on average, we have testosterone flooding through our bodies. We're built differently. Through evolution, if men were the ones fighting, they won the war and women had to be protected. Like this, I don't have to like repeat these narratives.
And it's ridiculous. People can't like I talked to my girl a lot about this when we first met, was the roles thing. Like, us being different does not make us not equal. Like, do I think you should be able to go like do just normal things I do? Yes. You're a human being, like whatever, but don't expect that we are the same. Like, we have different roles. We do different things. And I told her, she's actually in my room right now. She's probably listening to me. I told her like when we first met, because she had never really been with someone like me, like past relationships were kind of, I don't know, whatever you want, not like us. I don't know what you want to call us. And I remembered seeing Mr. T talk about this. I was like, if we're walking down the street, because she kept trying to pay for things. And I was like, no, like put your fucking card away. You're never paying for anything as long as we're together, like ever. Like that is my job. She's like, what do you mean it's your job? I'm like, that is my job the same way it's your job to make sure my house is taken care of, make sure I am taken care of, make sure like all the womanly things that we need. I was like, if we're walking down the street and someone attacks you, whose job is it to defend you? She's like, oh, I don't need you to protect me. And that's when I started to realize how deep it is. Bro, they have never seen real world conflict, so they can't even understand. And I think that's another problem too, is like, reality is completely different than what they think a lot of things are in their head, and that has never set in. And the day that it does, which I think will come sometime soon, the way everything's happening, we might not even have to worry about feminism because it's going to flip back on its head.
Yeah, I think it will too.
Yeah.
One of the first things, this was a big green flag, for my girlfriend was our first date or second date. We were talking about just hookup culture and such. And she said, well, I actually think one of the biggest problems in the world is the feminist movement. And I was like,
oh man.
Wow. Okay. And obviously not in this, like, she's a very strong woman. She's like, women should be paid equal if they're performing the same as men. Women should have equal, you know, equal rights, of course. But but yeah, women have different roles, and she understands that fully. And like, yeah, it's just obvious, you know. And it's also like, I have so much admiration for her. Like, my life is so much better with her in it than it was before. And it's like, it's proving to be like, and you, I think a really good thing to do for men who are considering getting into a relationship or who are already in a relationship is to simply audit the statistics of your life. Like, if you're making more money now with a girlfriend than before, probably a good relationship. And I know I certainly am. And part of the reason is because, like, I'm looking at my bed right now, my bed is made. I've never had my bed made ever. Like, my room is
Dude, those are like, huge. Those are so, so big.
Huge. Like, my clothes are hung up in my closet.
Yeah. I was just about to say that. Like, I told her when we first met, and I also, I believe you kind of have to build a girlfriend a little bit in our world, more so than find them. So we talked about this a lot, and now it's I never even had to mention it now. I get made breakfast. Oh, dude, you probably saw it on Twitter, like this big wood platter of just fucking deliciousness. Laundry's made, coffee made for me every morning. And I explained to her, I was like, listen, you don't need to try to make money and compete with me, because if you help me just focus more on the thing I'm good at, like if you're an NBA player and you're able to play basketball all day rather than a little bit, you're going to be better. Business is the same thing. I was like, the more time you give me away from bullshit, like doing my laundry, making food, whatever, keeping my house clean, putting me in a good mood, whatever, the more we are abundant. And it's not a me versus you. I make more money than you. We're not competing. It is we're a team. You're helping me to give us more than we would have without. So, and I think that's what modern girls drop the ball on. They feel inferior because of media and whatever. It's like, oh, if he makes more money than me, I'm inferior. No, you're not inferior. I'm just simply better at this than you are. And that's fine. You're better at making food than I am. You're better at nurturing than I am. I can't take a house and make it a home. Like, I can't make life from my body, you know? No, and I think that's what a lot of modern girls our age just don't understand.
Yeah. Yes.
We're doing good though. Because I've seen you talk about your girl on Instagram. I think we're doing pretty good on that side.
She's fantastic. Normally she's right when I record these things, but the thing is, I mean, I've experienced the opposite. Mm-hmm. I've experienced when it was bad. And that was when I had a lot of these left-wing beliefs of like, men and women have the same role, and like, you know, I just didn't understand.
Did you have those beliefs at one point?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I mean, I never would have thought that like my girlfriend should do these more traditional feminine roles. I never thought that. And because of that, there were conflicts and there were issues. Like my previous,
it's even more impressive that you are who you are. Since you like started with those beliefs, because like I was raised super conservative. Like my mom looks at like modern girls and is disgusted. And like, dude, I never cooked for myself at home. I never did my laundry. Like I wasn't spoiled by any means in that sense. Like we were broke and I still had to work and stuff, but like she was so nurturing and so good. Then when I started dating in real life, I was like, wow, these girls suck, especially in Miami. So for you to actually have those beliefs and be where you're at now, that's very impressive. Cause that's a complete like identity shift in your mind, which is awesome.
Yeah, I definitely had to learn it all on my own. And I think here's the difference between what we're talking about and the opposing view is that we don't take offense to someone that wants to have the relationship where basically the roles are reversed. Like I'm not really offended if you want to be a guy who's doing the laundry and cooking the food and your girl makes all the money.
Couldn't be me, but you have a good time.
I don't care if you want to do that. All I'm saying is, my personal experience and just judging by the nature of men and women and how we're built biologically, there seems to be a trend of who's better at what. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
I think you're better, like male and female, you're way better to each other and you're way better together when you understand what your role is and you go all in on that rather than trying to play in the middle. Like polarity attracts. She is so feminine. Like she's a model, does girly stuff, whatever. Like extremely feminine. I'm on the complete other spectrum. There is no middle ground there. And when she tries to do the middle ground stuff, there's problems. Like we get in arguments where I'm like, hey, like this is not going to happen or whatever. But there's never, ever, ever a single problem when she's on that complete other spectrum.
Yeah. Another thing I think is that guys mess up on when they basically they don't know or they don't feel comfortable with the traditional gender roles. And so they get upset with their girl when she doesn't basically act like a man, you know, like if she, like, for example, one thing I try to not do with my girl, because she has women, female nature is like, if you just think about, we are animals, right? Like we are.
Yeah.
And if you think about, and you know, you don't really get mad that female birds build the nest, right? And the male birds go out and hunt and bring the food back to the nest.
Yeah.
Right? And female nature is nesting. Like they like to stay home and they like, it's at least my girlfriend, my personal experience, my girlfriend loves to stay home and be like, she could sit on her laptop and be in bed like all day and be perfectly happy. Like I need to go out for a walk. I need to go out and like sun my balls on the roof. Like I need to go do all these things. I need to travel.
Yeah.
And sometimes I get upset with her and this is something I have to stop. I'm like, you just like to stay home all day. And she's like, yeah, I do. What's wrong with that? You know? And I have to catch myself and basically bring myself back to like, you know what? That's just female nature. Like she enjoys that. And don't get me wrong. There obviously are times when she enjoys travel, when she enjoys going out, but more so she's on the side of like, I want to stay within and I want to build.
That's much better. That's much, much better. Because if you find a girl that constantly is out and at the club and amongst other people and wants to be in that scene, there is no shot that girl becomes a good wife. No chance in hell. No chance. Like my girl went out with her friends last night to what's it called? Sexy Fish is like a new place here in Miami. But that's like, she hasn't gone out with her friends in, God, I don't even remember when. We got back from Greece a month ago. Like I can't remember the last time. And that's fine. Mm-hmm. Like you go out, still enjoy your life. But then the other time is just here, like in my house, same thing you said. And I think that's you should reinforce that behavior, not get mad at her. Like reinforce it, be like, oh, I love this so much, like whatever.
Yes. Yeah. Positive reinforcement is good.
Yeah.
That's another thing I've learned about female nature is that men are motivated by the negative charge. Like we're motivated by Luke. You're a loser, bro. Like, what's your MRR right now? That's weak.
Women, I'm really bad at this with her, bro. That's something I had to learn. I did not know how to talk to her properly. And like, she would just get so sad and be like, why are you being so mean to me? And in my head, I'm like, I'm not being mean. I'm helping you. Like, no, I sound like I'm talking to my team and my employees, not my girlfriend.
Exactly.
There's a big difference.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of guys have to learn that 100%. Let's talk about why relationships are the new flex. What are your thoughts on that?
I actually talked about this. Who did I talk to this about? Maybe a Twitter space. I can't remember. So if you think you're a guy and you got your shit together, you're the man, right? Like both of us, we're the fucking man, bro. We're both making we're top 1% men our age, right? How old are you?
25.
Oh shit. I didn't know you're 25. So I'm 22. So okay. We're still 1% of our age. Looks, athleticism, health, income. What else do you want to put the marker at? I don't know, but we're the man. We could easily go bang like 500 girls a year. Like no problem. Dude, I'm in Miami. I could like put a post out right now, have like 10 girls here. Like it's not hard. And a lot of dudes, especially when you first start like to actually become a man, you're 18, whatever. That's the flex. It's like, oh bro, I fucked like 3 girls this week, whatever. That's the flex. I don't think that's impressive at all. I got out of that so fast. And now the only thing that impresses me, like if I talk about that with guys, is like, okay, like what level of girl is she? Because if you hung out with her for the first time and she slept with you, she's trash. I don't care what anybody says. It doesn't matter how good your game is. Like, it doesn't matter. She's trash. And so I think the new flex is not how many girls can you sleep with. It's the quality of the girls that you can keep around and what those girls do for you. So, like, I think my girl is literally, like, the most beautiful woman I have ever seen in my life. Like, literally, when I was a little kid, I love blondes, right? That's my thing. When I'm a little kid, the girl I'm, like, imagining and I'm like, oh, I want that one day is my girlfriend. But that's not even the flex at all. The flex is I come home from MMA and she makes me dinner or she makes me my coffee in the morning or my bed is always made. My house is always clean. My clothes are always put away. That's the flex. You and I have bad girlfriends, bro. But that's like the service level. They take care of us and they enabled us to be even better than we are by ourselves. That is more of a flex than anything. We could totally go bang 30 girls in a month, whatever. Whatever. It's not a flex. It's not impressive. Anybody can do that. But not anybody can get the highest quality of women to love them and care for them in that manner. So I think that's how I would explain it.
I think you broke it down perfectly. Yeah. It is that like 18 to 21 year old thing that was programmed into us. Actually, it's probably more like 14 to 21 year old. And I think it was probably more so programmed into us by whoever's controlling the internet and the porn industry. I think, you know, and the narratives and the movies and I just remember growing up watching American Pie. That was like my favorite movie. And I thought Eric Stifler was like the man because like he's banging all the girls in college. And then, of course, you know, from the age of 12, most girls don't understand this. Guys are watching porn at sleepovers all together. And they're like, and then they get a porn addiction at 12 years old. And then they're just jerking off all the time. And then that's when they become anxious and depressed because they're depleting themselves of dopamine and, you know, all the chemicals that would naturally be reserved for real success in life. And they're just wasting it down the toilet, like multiple times a day, watching graphic images of basically prostitutes on the internet.
Turns your brain to mush.
Yeah, it's so bad. And it's very difficult to kick, bro. I have friends that still deal with this. Like, you know, 30-year-old men that are addicted to pornography. Like, and it's holding them back. And they also don't even know it's a problem. So
that's the worst.
That we're programmed to think this. And it ruins their relationship. Like, I actually have friends that have had their relationship end because of a porn problem. Because the girl was uncomfortable with it and the guy didn't think it was an issue and was like, you can't tell me what I can and can't watch. Like, duh, duh. And meanwhile, you know, he's struggling financially and, you know, there's other problems there that come along with it. And so whoever programmed that in that hookup culture mentality into us is the dark force that we're fighting. And yeah, as soon as you can make the leap and realize that The thing is, and I'm sure you had your phases as well. Unfortunately, most men have to go through that phase to realize the light that it's not that cool. And then once you've done it, and either you've done it and you've had the, you know, whatever, three girls a week type lifestyle, or you just observe guys who are doing it and you just see how empty it is and how hurtful it is to women and, you know, how it doesn't actually help you perform in life. You know, you're able to see what the real winners are doing, you know?
Yeah. And that's, we're a part of that problem of like we think modern girls are not it, or I don't want to say trash, but just not the way we're kind of that problem, dude. And I know I was like, when I was 18, I got cheated on by this girl in high school. I was like the last person to find out at my school. Like the one in the relationship, I was the last one to find out. And like something else awful happened that night. So it was really bad. So I was like, okay, fuck this girl. I'm going to go on like a war path. And I did throughout.
Before you explain that end of that story, why did she cheat on you? Or what was the situation?
I have no idea. Honestly, I have no idea. Her dad was a preacher.
Okay. So wait, so she was just out at a party without you or something?
No, just so she lived like 45 minutes away from me. And okay. Keep in mind, I was like super poor, dude. I had the shittiest car. I was not the man then at all. Yeah, right. Yeah. Didn't look like this. Didn't have any facial hair. So I mean, I probably would have cheated on myself too. I was probably a loser. But I don't know. I know she just like met up with this other dude who's also a fucking loser now. He was kind of like one of the it's one of the like stereotypical. Yeah, like he was like a good athlete, and I was a good athlete as well. But I had all these other problems going on behind the scenes that then impacted everything. Like, didn't even have a cell phone till I was like 17. So how am I going to like talk to text friends and whatever? So I guess I just didn't have the swag then, and this guy did. And she was like, "Okay, I'm gonna go hang out with this guy." And then I heard about it. Oh shit! So this is college.
This is college.
Yeah, that's college.
So this is after.
Here, go down. I might have pictures. Yeah, so this is high school. So somewhere in between these football pictures, that was prom. That was at my friend's house. Somewhere in between those pictures, it happened. And
that's fire, yeah. Bro. Thank you,
bro. that was like the nicest. That was the nicest thing that I had done. But somewhere in between these pictures, because of senior year, and I just decided I'm like going to go on a warpath, and I did. And I'm not going to talk about a number, but like I racked up like a lot of bodies, if you want to call it that, and got a lot of experience, whatever. And then I started to realize, like, holy shit, bro, these girls. Like, I'm doing – you go to a party in college, right? It's to sleep with girls. You don't go to mm-hmm. see guys, whatever, right?
Yeah.
So you're doing everything in your power to manipulate these girls into sleeping with you. Obviously, yeah. You're the man. And I'm – like, you look at it through a different lens. Oh, I'm cool. I'm talking to them. They like me. But you know what you're doing. You're trying to manipulate their behavior and your behavior to reach a certain outcome. It destroys them. Like, mm-hmm. like women biologically – I don't care what you say about religion, whatever – biologically, you're designed to bond with the first person you sleep with more than anybody else. That's why we don't find a high body count favorable. It's biological. It's not anything else. So, bro, we're fucking girls up. I broke probably X amount of girls' hearts, and maybe they have problems because of that. And I can't really do anything about that now. So, I mean, we're part of that problem, which is an issue. And I didn't have... I don't know about you, but I did not have like a masculine figure or a dad to tell me like, hey, don't do that. Or this is how you should handle this getting cheated on. Or this is how you should handle this, whatever. Because I didn't want to talk about it. I was embarrassed. So I was like, fuck it. Warpath. And then you realize that's probably not what I should do.
Yeah, it's I resonate with that. Although I would say mine was kind of reversed. The war path of the hookup thing, the hookup mentality started in high school. Just again, American Pie, being in a locker room full of guys at a public high school, you know, it's competition. It's who's hooking up with the hottest girl and the amount of the number of girls. And then, you know, I went to college. And it's funny, like growing up, you think that the schools that are like Christian schools or religious schools are like stupid because there's like a guy's school and like sexual promiscuity is frowned upon. And you're like, that's so lame. I'd never do that. But growing up, you kind of see why those things exist. And then, yeah, I mean, I definitely damaged my first girlfriend when I was 18. Like I was just a bad guy. I was just mean. And I was super insecure.
Yeah.
Then college was just, you know, endless amounts of casual relationships here and there. The one thing I will say, though, that I think we've given our, obviously, like, we're leading this charge as the men, but like women are programmed for hookup culture too. They certainly
are. No, yeah. I mean, they're looking for it in the same light.
They are.
But
especially the women who've been hurt by that first guy, they're like, I want revenge. You know, I want to go on my, whatever they call it, my whore phase or whatever.
City girls.
Yeah, it is a thing, you know, and it's propagated through media and just.
And it hurts no one but themselves. If a dude breaks your heart and then you go sleep with 10 guys, You played yourself.
Yeah.
You just lowered your own value. You just caused yourself more problems. And if you're like, damn, that hurts. Okay. Now I need to be more selective of the guys I date, which isn't how it goes.
Yeah. So there was that like hookup culture that I found myself in. And then I got the shit kicked out of me, psychologically and socially in the relationship that I got into, where, it was a public relationship. At this time I had like several hundred thousand YouTube subscribers, started dating this girl who I met in Australia, and it was public. Like, it was, you know, everyone knew she was my girlfriend. My YouTube channel was blowing up because of it. We were doing couples videos, and then she ended up cheating on me with Cameron Dallas, actually.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And similar to you, everyone knew about it before me, because
that's the
worst. My followers were like direct messaging me pictures of her and him. And then I was like, oh, what's going on? I ended up finding out. 2 days later, she archived every Instagram picture that we had together. I was also helping her build a YouTube channel, and she like took down her videos. And then she posted one Getty Images paparazzi photo with the guy. And so that was like my slap in the face of like, wow, I probably deserve that. But even then, you know, I still, like after that, I was definitely damaged for a while. And then it just took me a lot of self-reflection. And I will say, I definitely went through like a hookup culture phase after that, when I moved to LA and I had a house in the hills and, you know, was kind of living a playboy lifestyle for a while. And I will say, I don't want to like virtue signal and say, you know, being in a relationship is like the ultimate thing that you can do, because realistically, like, you know, is it better for society? Probably, but who are we to say that it's like, you know, the most virtuous path? Like, is it? I don't know. I mean, some people, like, people can live their life how they want. Have you read Sex at Dawn?
Mm-mm.
That's interesting. It just talks about like polygamy and all that kind of stuff, which is a thing. And then, of course,
that won't be happening with any relationship I have, at least not on the girl's side. And that's another thing, but I don't know. I've been very, very good boy in this relationship.
Yeah. Yeah. And me too. But yeah, I mean, it just took a while, man. It took a while of like unprogramming myself to realize that what we're talking about here, which is like a relationship, is a flex. Yeah. And hopefully we can start promoting that more. It's just hard, because when you're creating a brand and you're, you know, you don't want to look like a dork, you know, and most guys, especially that we're creating content for and ultimately selling to, they look up to us and they think they want to be us for a specific reason. But I don't know, man, this is stuff that pops around in my head a lot.
Same. I mean, we can only speak from our experience, you know, and we're just doing the best we can to guide people on mistakes we made, lessons we've learned through that. So I don't know. Did you have trust issues still from that? Because that's the one thing, like if I had any like issue, whatever, I just do not trust girls at all ever since that happened. And it's easier. That's why having a relationship for me is really weird. It's so much easier to be a playboy. I don't give a fuck about these girls. Like, okay, you come to my house, you leave, I take you out to dinner, leave. Doesn't matter what you do. I don't care. Like, because I'm not going to get hurt because of that. But then you have a relationship, especially like we do, it's public. Hundreds of thousands of people have seen me and this girl. If something were to happen, everyone's going to know, you know, like everybody will know. That's a lot scarier to me. So sometimes I catch myself in that pattern of like, I still don't trust anybody. I don't know what could happen. You don't know people's intentions, especially in our modern world. You know, it's very interesting. So I was curious if you dealt with that.
Yeah, I think it's like, this definitely came down to my selection process of my girl. Mm-hmm. One of the first conversations we also had was like, she doesn't drink, she doesn't smoke, she doesn't do drugs. She grew up in LA, but which is like a, you have to have a butt after that, because vast majority of girls that grow up in LA are party girls.
Yeah.
Her dad has 6 brothers and 2 sisters, and they all live within 10 minutes of each other in the Valley in LA. Mm-hmm. She has 30 cousins. Every Friday they would have Shabbat dinner. So instead of going to parties, she would hang out with her family.
That's very admirable.
Yeah. And then when she did go to parties, she was designated driver. Hookup culture is blasphemy in her family. And because they're so close, you know, any girl who's considered a slut is like looked down upon. So like loyalty is baked into her DNA. I don't distrust her at all. I more so distrust men's intentions. And if she's out without me, which A, she doesn't like to go out without me. Mm-hmm. Like she likes to go to a nice dinner or watch a movie or go to a Broadway show. She would prefer that over like a drunken, like, you know, whatever, where there's no real conversations happening. So she doesn't like to do that, A, but B, I look at it as more of like a protection thing where, you know, I mean, there was a time we were in Mykonos together and we were out and it was like 2 or 3 in the morning. And she was kind of like sitting about 10-15 feet away from me. It was very popular in the streets of Mykonos. You were just in Greece recently.
Yeah, right? I was in Naxos. I had something happen that I think you're about to say as well. We'll see.
Dude, yeah. So a guy, this like older guy, this guy was like 35 or 40 years old. He went up to my girlfriend and started talking to her, and he had another girl with him. And Chloe was just sitting there. And I was kind of watching. I was like, okay, like, what's this guy doing? And then he leans over and kisses her on the forehead. Like, grabs her face and kisses her on the forehead. I'm like,
oh, I would have
caught up and I pushed the guy off. And I was like, bro, what are you doing? So there's nothing she could really do. Like, she was just sitting there and he grabbed her. Yeah. And so it's more so that, like, how am I supposed to protect you if you're out without me and you're in one of these environments where, again, I don't think girls recognize the reality of like what men are capable of, especially when they have alcohol in their system and they see a girl as attractive as mine or yours, just out, you know, out and about.
It's just like prey, bro.
They're prey. And we know that because we were once that, you know, it's like, if there's a girl out and her boyfriend's not there, she does not have a boyfriend. I'm going to swoop in and I'm going to say something to her and I'm going to make a move. And that's how men think. And, you know, it's just, it's not cool. It's not cool. So that's kind of how I think about it. And these are just, you know, these are expectations and standards you have to say at the start of your relationship. It's more difficult to bring them in over time, but I was super clear with her when we started, and I was upfront and basically said, you know, if you're going to want to go out and party, you know, I'm not the guy for you. So it's just something you have to say.
Same. I think it's very important. Do you want to talk about this more or do you want to talk about something else? Cause I could talk about anything all day. I think we have a good,
I could go another 30, 40 minutes easy.
Oh no, we can go for as long as you want. How many people are live? Can you see? Cause
there's been a consistent like 80 to 100 people live.
It's fire. Let me see if Twitter is popping.
Yeah, bro.
Is there any questions from people?
The chat's been mostly, I don't know if you can see the chat, but there's been
I'll
couple
up the YouTube, but I'll have to mute it.
Oh, here's a good one. Seeing as you guys are definitely not even close to your peak SMV yet, sexual market value now yet, 35-ish, how do you balance settling down now into a relationship versus waiting till your peak? Someone said block Holden. Yeah, Holden's super annoying. No offense, bro. I'm going to block him. I blocked him. Can't post comments in some destinations.
Oh wow, there's a lot of these on here.
So, did you catch that question that I just read out? How do you balance your relationship now versus you know, waiting till your peak?
Well, like, it depends what your goal is, right? So like, I have no family. I obviously don't have anything to do with my dad's side at all. And I don't even know where they are, who they are. My mom's side, everyone died. So it's literally my mom and my brother and me. It's like my family. So I want to have a big family. I want to have a lot of kids. I want to kind of go contrary to what is what's happening in popular culture right now. I want to have a big family, a lot of kids, raise them traditionally, and just create like an army of awesome human beings, right? So I don't want to do that when I'm 30 years old. I'll hit my peak at 30, 35, whatever. I don't want to wait till then, because then my kids are going to be, by the time I'm 50, my kids will be what, 18, 20? I don't want to do that. So I'd much rather find a girl that is worthy of that and starting a family with now and build a relationship with her and then have kids younger than I would wait. And I see that all the time. Like, oh, men hit their peak later, whatever. Just be the man now. Like, become the man as quickly as you can be, and then you can get whoever you really want. And if you find one worthy of it, you just start early. At least that's my viewpoint.
Yeah. I would agree. I have a sort of similar situation on my end. And I think it's a question that all guys have to evaluate. You know, it's like, yeah, of course we're not going to be at our peak until we're whatever, 35, our sexual market value. For those of you that don't know what is even being referred to, I'll pull it up. But Rollo Tomasi, who wrote...
Rollo.
He wrote The Rational Male and several other books. He talks about the sexual market value, which is not to be confused with human value. It just is, you know,
when you're most desirable,
as a man or a woman. Let's see, Chrome tab. Here we go. So this is the curve, right? And it's basically just taken off of, you know, surveys and data. I don't know why pancreas is showing. Sinus, whatever that is. But you know, the pink is women. And the reason is because if you survey men ages 16 to 100, they're going to vote on average that the most attractive women is ages 20 to 25.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to say that, I mean, it's also like scientifically, women are most capable of producing fertile offspring between those ages because that's when they have the healthiest blood running through their body and the healthiest hormones and everything at 20 to 25. And that tends to wane over time. Whereas the reason people say men, and it's actually interesting, you can make an argument about this because actually men's sperm is healthiest at like 20 to 25.
Mm-hmm.
And it definitely wanes over time. But the reason that this chart is the way it is because most men don't reach their peak in terms of, success and ability to provide resources. So whereas, you know, a guy who gets to 35 is probably like you and I, when we're 35, we're going to be 100x. Like,
it's going to be crazy.
Yeah. But honestly, like, I mean, I'm going to be fine. Like, I don't plan on having kids right now, but in like 2, 3, 4 years, like I'm going to be completely fine in regard to that.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, to be honest, if it were to happen today, like it wouldn't be that big of an issue. But yeah, I mean, so that's one thing to consider is like the sexual market value curve is an average, and that's taking into consideration guys who are making probably what's the average male minimum or average male wage in the US is what, like 80-100 grand a year.
No way, dude. Average, way lower, probably like 60 grand, 50 grand. Yeah.
That's tough.
Yeah. But, lower, to be honest, like average, like across every male, definitely way lower.
Yeah. So like, as far as male income goes, you and I are probably above the average peak of the 35 year old. Yeah. So
for us, it doesn't really matter.
It doesn't really matter. Exactly. And I mean, my family situation, like, I mean, I have, I love my mom and dad more than anything. They're on the older side. My mom is 61. My dad is 71. And like, I want to have a family where they have grandkids. And yeah. So that's part of the thing that drives me a lot is like, I want to be with my mom and my dad, and I want them to be capable. I want, like, my dad is in amazing shape for 71. And he, you know, I want them both to be able to have grandkids and have and experience that. So that's part of my rush. I wouldn't even say it's a rush though. Like if you look back 50, 75 years, like our grandparents probably got married at 18, 19.
Dude, I was talking with her about this because she's like, I want a puppy. And I was laughing. She's like, why are you laughing? I was like, because no matter how fucked up our society gets, your guys' biology will never change. I was like, the reason you want a puppy so bad right now is because you should have children that you're like playing with and raising all day. I was like, that's why you're complaining about being bored and you want a puppy to fill that void. And it's kind of like, dude, honestly, I would love to be in that society. To be honest, like you have kids that young and then you're married for life to that person. You have to worry about as much bullshit. That's great. Like this sounds ideal compared to what we have to deal with. And now girls are trying to have children when they're like 29. Way too old. That's way too old. We can be 29, but that's why, and we'll probably get canceled. And that's why there's new 18-year-olds made every day, you know? And it's not bad. That's ideal. That's just how the world works.
What are your thoughts on male promiscuity in exclusive relationship?
So this is interesting too. I don't think any actual high value girl is going to want to be cheated on. Like obviously we ideally would, you ask any dude like, yeah, can I have 5 girlfriends? Cool. I'll try it. Whatever. But then like, if you actually do that and you actually have done that, like I have done that here in Miami, dude, it's kind of a pain in the ass to be honest. It's kind of a headache. It's not really worth it. Like after a while you just get annoyed. Like it's not, at least for me. And I don't think any actual high value girl is going to be okay with being cheated on because they will feel that's disrespectful. If a girl's okay with it, it's because I don't think she can get with the kind of man that won't do that to her, if that makes sense. And I've thought about this a lot because Mr. T talks about this. I know a lot of other people talk about this.
Bro, I can't get over Mr. T.
Yeah, that's hilarious. But like
it sounds like
your girlfriend. Would your girlfriend be okay with you just cheating on her and then expecting her to just be happy? Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely not.
Yeah. And I think that's unfair to them because even if you do pull it off, which like I think I could pull it off, and because I think she loves me enough that she'd be like, okay, whatever. She will never, ever, ever have the same trust, the same bond, the same love for me because that has like that's a stain in your relationship you can't get rid of. And I don't think What's that called? I don't think the juice is worth the squeeze in that case.
Agree. There's a, I do have a friend or two that have the situation, and what happened and the way it was created was they were in the exclusive relationship and then they cheated and then they cheated again and then they broke up. And then what happened was because that man was so high value, in the sense that like, even though he slipped up and he cheated, he was still the best boyfriend in the world. Like it, and the cheating wasn't like he was taking another girl on a date. It was like, he was on vacation and then like one thing led to another and, you know, he ended up with a different girl. And then he never talked to those girls again. It wasn't like he was trying to manage multiple relationships.
Yeah.
But then what happened was they broke up and then she started trying to date other guys. And essentially what she realized is that no one matched up to him. So she came back and was like, hey, like I need to be back with you because all these other guys basically suck.
Yeah.
And he was like, okay, but if that's what you want to do, then it's going to have to be like, you're going to have to let me occasionally go outside. Now, I don't have all the answers, but from my perspective, I don't think that I'm kind of on your side in the sense of like, it does break trust. It does whittle the relationship down a bit, but here's the reason that I think that men and women are better sticking to each other. And it's this.
Yeah. She shows me that all the time. My favorite color is black. Her favorite color is white. and bro, she's blonde and pale and I'm dark. We're like, that's a common theme that we talk about all the time.
Yeah, it's the masculine and feminine, and they're equally powerful. And it's not, you know, masculine thing and then like several different feminine parts of it. Like it's just the masculine energy, the feminine energy. And
Yeah.
You're more powerful as a team. You're more powerful as, you know, one person supplies that energy with the other person supplies that energy. And it just gets energetically confusing when you're going outside as a man and like putting your seed in different places. When it, in, if you, you know, if you're smart, you would take that energy, put it into your soul woman, mm-hmm. and then your business or businesses.
It's much better to do that. It's that's why I kind of just want to get the girl thing off of the list, bro. I want to focus on bigger things. Not that having the, obviously that's like the most important choice you'll make in your life, in large part, financially, whatever, if you get married, or whether you get with them and you get legally married or not, whatever. But like, if you get that out of the way, you've got a lot of leeway to focus on other things like business, purpose,
massive advantage. Mission.
Yeah, and then you're still taken care of. Like we talked about at the beginning of this video or this stream, is like a good woman will make your life 10 times easier and allow you to actually focus more. It takes care of a lot of things. So, I mean, I can see I would totally do that if I wasn't getting what I needed from a relationship. But even then, you're better off just breaking up with them and then finding somebody else. You know, like you're kind of just delaying the inevitable if you do that in the first place.
Oh, yeah, if she's making your life difficult, you know, you end it.
Yeah.
But if it's making your life better and yeah, you get that off your plate. It's like Alex Ramosi was talking about it on he has a great episode with Lewis House, and he talks about this toward the end. It's like mm-hmm. it's such a guys who are in a relationship have such an advantage in business, because when you're not in a relationship, you're spending a lot of time chasing girls around. And it's just easier when you have it set up.
Yeah, that takes a lot of time and energy, dude. And I think that's another part of, like, you know, in Think and Grow Rich, when the big one is like the sexual transmutation, I think it's a big reason that men reach their peak a little bit later in life, is because you get that out of the way. And then you don't waste that energy and time and focus on just chasing girls anymore. That's a really big deal.
Kevin in the chat asked a good question. He said, how do you know if your girl is holding you back in a great situation or relationship? I have so many goals and aspirations to do and so many things.
Easy. You know if she's holding you back because you're not reaching where you think you could be. Like that's just common sense. Like if you think you could be farther ahead without her, she's holding you back.
Yeah, this would be kind of fun to do. I have a slideshow that, I mean, I obviously in Tribe Accelerator, I have, I talk about this quite a bit. And I have a 2.5-hour module called the Girlfriend Matrix, because it's just such a, you know, it's such a challenge for guys these days. And I broke down what I call the 6 relationship phases. And I think that this will easily answer this question. Let me just share screen. Curious your take on this as well, Luke.
Yeah.
The
girlfriend matrix.
So phase 1 is dating. Fun and light. You've just met. You're going on dates. It's typically non-exclusive. That's obviously up to you. But if you're a guy and you're dating, you're probably, you know, you probably are trying out, experimenting in different ways with different girls and seeing who you like and seeing who you don't. And then at some point, one of those girls or multiple start to ask you, hey, where is this going? Right? Where most guys mess up is they are the ones that try to push for the relationship. Now, there are rare cases where the guy is like, you're my girlfriend, and like, that's it. But most guys start to go, hey, do you like me?
Yeah, and it gives girls the ick.
Yeah, it gives girls the ick.
100%. I literally made her ask me to be her boyfriend. Like she was pissed, but I was like, hey, like if you want me to not go see other girls, you're going to have to ask me, cause I'm not going to like chase you. And she got kind of mad about it, but then asked me, and now like we're good.
Yeah. They'll do it in creative ways. I mean, mine, for example, was like, she was like, hey, what are you doing this Friday? And this was like 2 months into knowing each other, 1 or 2 months.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm free. And she goes, okay, do you want to come to this event? It's like this, you know, this dinner. And I was like, yeah, sure, I can come. And then after I agreed, she said, okay, by the way, my mom and dad are going to be there. How should I introduce you to them?
I love women. I love women.
You got me.
that's good.
Like, that's very clever. And I was just like, oh, just tell them we're dating. And so at that point, that's when you as a man have to start to evaluate, what do I actually want? And you should probably think about it before, you know, what are the character traits that you imagine?
Yeah.
But that takes you into phase two, which is the vetting phase. So this is fun and it's light, but you still have your guard up. And you are basically, you have your list of like standards, and you can tell her these standards. You know, I'm not going to date a girl who's partying every Friday night. I'm not going to, you know, date a girl that's doing X, Y, and Z, presenting herself in a certain way on social media, maybe, whatever your standards and guidelines are. Mm-hmm. And then you have to have a phase where you don't just say yes immediately. She has to show you that she is who she says she is and that she's agreeing to your standards.
I like this. So
one of the first things that I did is, and I told her, I was like, you know, I'm 25. I was like, are you sure you want to date me? Right. Because I was like, I need to travel. I need to sometimes go on trips without you, and you're going to have to be okay with that. And so she was like, yeah, that's fine. And so about a week after we had this conversation, something came up where Adam Horwitz actually invited me to Bali. And mm-hmm. I was like, hey, I got to go to Bali. My ex, like my previous girlfriend, would have been like, no, you can't go. Like, you're going to be with other girls. Like, I can't do that. And Chloe was like, okay, great. You want me to drive you to the airport? I was like, amazing. So then I went, and, you know, I had an amazing time. It led to some incredible business opportunities. And then she picked me up from the airport, and I was like, wow, that was cool.
Yeah.
She passed the test. Right. And so, I asked her what her standards would be. I wrote a list of all my standards. And then that brings you into phase three, which I call like the heaven period. And this is essentially where you want to just keep your relationship long term. And this is where everything's just beautiful. You know, it's, I assume, where you're at right now. You're fulfilling your role as a man. She's fulfilling her role as a woman. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the only thing you have to be careful of, and I'd actually be curious how you experience this, is what I call the softening.
Oh, dude. Yes. I literally told her that the other day.
It's like, the attempts to emasculate you and to make you weak.
And you know what's funny? I don't think females understand this. The reason they like you is because you're not feminine. But over time, they try to make you feminine, and then they don't like you. And then it's your fault. Does it make sense? No, females aren't logical. They're emotional. So yeah, I she's tried to do that to me, like, unintentionally. It's just like subconscious. And when I feel that, like, if I'm watching too many movies with her and like being cuddly and fucking being comfortable, I'm like, fuck this. And I go straight to MMA and I get punched in the face. Like, I'm like, I cannot do this anymore. I got to go be a man. That's hilarious. And that's a trap a lot of guys fall into, because girls like you for not being a bitch. She will try to turn you into a bitch. Like, she will. It's just how they do it. And you have to really be like, okay, we're getting a little too soft here. I need to go get hard again.
It's the watching movies you don't want to watch. It's going to events you don't want to go to. It's dressing in a way that you don't want to dress. It's taking time away from your business to, you know, do other shit that she wants you to do that you don't want to do. Yep. It's like eating slightly shittier. It's seeing your guy friends less and less. It's changing your political views slowly. And there's obviously nothing wrong with being like influenced by your partner, but you still have to stay strong to your masculine core values and like be the man that she originally was attracted to.
Yeah. And women love when your mission takes priority over them, even if they don't say it. Big secret to every guy listening to this: women do not say what they mean. So like, if she says like, I want you to spend more time with me, whatever, whatever. Okay, if you're not spending any time with her, yes, common sense. But like, what she really means is not what she says at all. Like, she loves that you don't give her all your time. The second you do give a girl all your time, they get the ick, bro. They're like, this guy's, if he's that easy, like, to get my time or get his time, it's probably not worth very much.
Yeah.
That's funny how that works. What other questions you got in here? This is very, I need to do some of these. I really like this, bro.
It's fun, dude. This has been an awesome stream. Put a 100 in the chat if you're enjoying this stream.
Big 100.
Dude, what I was actually thinking about is, again, I think, you know, I like Aiden Ross. I think he's funny. I like some of the streamers that are popping out there. But, bro, why aren't guys like you and me doing streams and, like, doing
– I need to. I would do one every day, to be honest. I honestly didn't know what StreamYard was. I was like, how do I do this? Like, OBS?
I'm learning, too. I literally did a stream the other day, and my mic was down on the table like this, and I just did the whole stream like this, and I forgot. Like, I'm learning. Bro, my screen sharing is awful. I don't know how to do the Discord thing. You can do a stream from your Discord to YouTube. That's a whole nother thing.
Don't know.
How about this? Where is it? I forget.
A lot of hundreds, a lot of thousands.
Oh, thoughts on traditional marriage registering with the state officially versus a ban between you and your girl with no state intervention.
Dude, honestly, I don't think I'm going to do it because there's no fucking chance that I'm going to give a woman any ability to take anything from me in the case that she does not want to be with me anymore.
Yeah.
No chance. Zero chance. Prenups don't work. Fuck that. I don't care how much I trust a girl. I don't know. So probably won't do it.
You have to have something, right? Because I'm pretty sure the government, and maybe it's state dependent, but I'm pretty sure the government, if you're living together with your girl, like, determines here, you as.
Say hi to everybody. This is Brooke. This is Arlin.
Hi.
Yo, we should connect your girlfriend and my girlfriend so they have, like, good actual friends.
Yeah, that's an issue. That's
does your girl have that issue too? Well, actually, I don't know. I'm not gonna say this. Last time I did one of these, listen, bro, the last time I did a podcast, I got in trouble. But we should connect them.
They
need good friends. Yeah, they need good friends.
Yeah, they yeah. We'll connect them for sure.
Yeah, we should. That's a great idea. She says definitely. What other questions we got? Please marriage. Take over streaming. Would be amazing to see you guys on homepages. Yeah, I'm down. Is it lame to still be a virgin at 21 for religious reasons? Had a few chances to lose it, but chose not to. I don't think it's lame, dude. I think it's pretty admirable, to be honest. But what you want to make sure is that you find a girl who is also a virgin. Because if you are for religious reasons and you find a girl that's not, and she's already had sex with a bunch of guys, her expectations are going to be off, and you're probably not going to be good at it when you first do it. And then you're fucked. Like, you're very fucked. Because I'm telling you right now. What was that guy's name? I don't know his name. I'm telling you right now. It doesn't matter how good your girl is. And this is just a reality of life. If you cannot lay it down as good as her past partners, which is why it's good to sleep with girls that don't have high body counts, she'll constantly think of that. And you will never be able to get out of that. It's just reality. So either get really good or find one that is also... virgin is like you.
That's something I think isn't talked about enough, because
you got to be good, dude. You got to.
You can be a 1% man in every other area of life, but if you can't please her in the bedroom,
yeah, she'll want to cheat on you. She'll think about other dudes. It's just not a good solution. You really got to be the man in that aspect.
And that's bro. That's like, this is something I think Mr. T talked about a lot that no other men talk about. It's like, life is hard for men, bro. Like, how are you supposed to get good? Like, the fact that you can be a multimillionaire, ripped out, like, you can be have chiseled jawline, like, you can be in your prime, but if you can't perform sexually, it can be taken all away from you. You can be brutally embarrassed. And yeah.
Bro, it's a reality, which kind of is like, fuck. But I don't know. Like, I myself... I think it's very admirable. What was this guy's name? I want to say his name. Christian. Wow, Christian and Christian.
Christian and Christian.
I think it's very admirable. But honestly, myself, I wouldn't regret what I have done, because now I am good at those things and I don't have to worry about that. And I know it sounds very superficial or kind of like whatever. It depends on your values, right? But for me, like, I'll never have an issue with that now, so I don't have to worry about it. So I don't know. It depends. But that's what I would say.
Yeah. I'll admit it was an issue for me for a little while, because I was just, I mean, bro, like, I fully understand it. Like, on one hand, you're insecure because, oh,
You're froze, it looks like.
Oh, no, that looked bad. Someone's calling me on that.
Bro, that face. You're froze. You're froze.
Oh, Chloe's calling me. Hold on a second. I got to answer this.
You're good.
Did I answer it? Oh, no, she stopped calling. Connection disrupted. Can you hear me? Hold up. Hold up, everybody.
Luke's in the bathroom.
Oh, Luke's in the bathroom. Okay. Guys, hold tight. Drop your questions in the chat. Luke's girlfriend, what's her name? Brooke?
Yeah, Brooke.
Nice to meet you. I'm going to have my girlfriend come and maybe we can interview them.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, wait. Okay. I had to pee really bad. Brooke. Are you Arlin? Where's your camera?
I'm coming back. Yeah, she was just calling me. I figured out that you can actually you can use your phone as a streaming thing.
Here, sit on my legs so you don't fall over.
I'm a mess.
You're not a mess. You look great. Eating raw carrots. Carrots are good. Give your girl carrots because they remove excess estrogen from the body, which is like poisonous.
Really?
Yeah. Bro science.
Wow.
Put that on soul, bra.
I'm on with soul, bra, Tuesday.
Oh, really? I mean, you met him too. He was at the day I met you.
Yeah. Yeah, he's great.
Yeah, I really like his stuff.
Yeah, he's dope.
Questions we got in here. Thoughts on Neville Goddard. Who the hell is that?
Neville Goddard is he's like a manifestation dude. Yeah, he's like, I forget what his thing is, but he has a famous book and like Neville Goddard's secret key to something. He's kind of like a Napoleon Hill.
Okay. I mean, that stuff's all very real. Like and you are too. Like we're walking testaments of it, you know? Like there's no reason I should be where I'm at. I should be like poor and or dead or on drugs. Like that's all that there is from where I'm from.
Bro, I feel like Aiden Ross right now. I'm about to do something sus.
Oh God.
Andrew, am I fat?
Dude, that was so funny. I was like, why would you do that?
Am I fat?
That was like the last thing you should do when you're talking to it. Oh shit, I can see him in here. I don't have to go to YouTube. Okay, good.
Right. I think that what we're going to do is we're going to just start a trend of like entrepreneurs taking over streaming. So it's not a bunch of fucking dorks.
Let's do some regularly because we have very similar stuff. I think people, it's better when we talk together than just alone.
Yeah.
Because we bounce things off of each other.
I don't think we have good
food. Look in the fridge. I have a lot of good food.
You have no good food.
Yeah, look in the fridge.
Oh, that's much better. Why haven't been? I don't know why I haven't been doing that the whole time.
You're in Boston, right?
Yes, I am.
Nice.
Check
my
the chat.
From upstate New York.
That's nowhere near, but. But cool.
Oh wait, really? Yeah. Where the fuck? I'm an idiot, dude. I have zero clue. Hey, chat, ask some fire questions and I'll answer them while he's gone. When do you want to get married and should you? So I don't know if I want like a government licensed marriage because like nothing, why would I let the government tell me that I'm married to somebody? But when should you? When you find the right girl. That's the easiest answer. don't rush into it. Make sure you vet the girl. It's one of the most important decisions you'll ever make in your life. Behind every good man is a great woman. It's like Abraham Lincoln or something.
Yeah, who said that?
I think that's, it was Lincoln, right?
It's funny because like I never believed that.
Yeah, my mentor has a good relationship, and she like perfectly supports everything he needs. He's like 65 though, and she's like 40, but like it's everything that you could want, you know. So it's a good example. Topic.
Why are so many guys single today?
Because they suck. Like, dude, the average guy is shit. Like, I'm just going to be real. Like, the average dude jerks off 5 times a day, is unhealthy, is uneducated, is lazy, is not fit, makes no money, has no aspirations. Like, why would a girl want to be with that? You know? Even basic girls like are pretty delusional. Like, oh, I want this 6 figures, 6 inches.
Bro, what is happening right now?
What is that?
This is not okay. What's happening right now? I don't know what is happening.
How do you do that?
I don't know. I just started tapping my camera lens, and this just happened. Captain, I'm gonna
Jack Arlin.
Bro, this is not okay. Oh no. No. No.
You look like a furry.
Oh my God, dude. Welcome back to the news. Today we're talking about the new jab that you can get so that you can get triple boosted, quadruple boosted. And today we're interviewing Luke Alexander. He's getting his 9th booster today. Luke, how are you doing?
I'm a big supporter of Biden and Fauci, and I think that the jab is a great idea.
New studies have come in that have shown that if you get your 9th jab, you are 50% likely to have a seizure. But we think that your medical expertise shows that you should still get one anyway. What are your thoughts?
Yo, did you see we can't talk about that, actually. We'll get canceled. My thoughts? I don't want it. I don't want it at all. What's a respectable income for a guy? It's got to be over 6 figures, dude. Like, with inflation especially, if you're not making, like, at least a couple $100,000 a year, you're still pretty limited into what you can do.
Oh,
he's back. There we go.
Dude, I didn't know that was possible. That was awesome.
What about the jab for monkeypox? Well, dude, the only way you get monkeypox is by having same-sex relations with another man. So if you're doing that, maybe you should get it. But
is that a
thing?
You
don't got to worry. Huh?
Is that true?
Yeah. 100%.
Really?
Yeah.
Monkeypox is from same-sex marriage, same-sex sex?
Butt stuff with guys. It's exactly what it is. Google it. Look it up. I swear.
Are you sure you're just not on base Twitter seeing memes?
I'm 99% sure. I could be wrong. There's 1% that I could be wrong, but I'm pretty. Let me look.
Like,
monkeypox. Pause. Yeah.
Oh, wow. I didn't know it was like that.
It says, yeah, sexually transmitted. I'm not saying that out loud, but yeah.
Wow. Okay.
It's eugenics, bro. Everyone, all these people like the virtue signal. They think that the elites love them. The elites don't like you more than they don't like us. They're trying to wipe you out. It's probably manufactured to take out a certain sector of people. I would not be surprised. Just like HIV. Why is everyone selling a course now? Because it's a beautiful business model and it allows you to live your best life and help people and make a lot of money.
Yeah. Yeah. If you know things, you should share and you should get paid for it.
Yeah.
Did we hit everything we wanted to talk about? I feel like there's a couple things we haven't hit yet.
I don't know. Let me look on our texts.
We were talking about that Twitter beef.
Good energy versus dark energy, how men can step up. Relationships, where you talked about that. Spiritual battle, we talked about that. Mike Malak beef.
Oh, yeah. You almost got into a – yeah, well, you did. You bought
him. Oh, bro, destroyed him. That was embarrassing on his end, especially, like, if you're famous and someone like myself does that to you, that's embarrassing.
Yeah, so what happened? What happened?
I have the whole exchange if you want me to read it. It's not like super long, but it's hard to like paraphrase what happened. Let me see. So basically, Mike Malak, I've seen on vlogs, like, sucking off Mr. T. That's the best way to say it, okay? And Mr. T is someone that I have a pretty decent amount of respect for, right? I don't love everything he does, but a lot of respect for the message and everything. So he said, he basically tweeted, subtweeting him, saying, women are not your property, not your slaves. You're not entitled to anything from them. No one's pushing this antiquated narrative should be idly allowed to indoctrinate. He's trying to use big vocab words. Basically, he's subtweeting Tate when Tate got banned, or Mr. T got banned that day, right? So I quoted it and I said, I love to stir the pot a little bit, right? It's fun. So I quoted it and said, homie dated a porn star and wants to speak on intersexual dynamics, LMAO. Got under his skin really bad. So he says, what does profession have to do with treating people with respect? Are sex workers discardable? Is that what you're saying here publicly? That's his reply. I replied with this meme and said, yes. And like, I know I'm like friends with girls that have OnlyFans and stuff. Like, I can still like you as a person and still have no respect for what you do and think it's not cool. Like, that's possible. So I was like, yeah, I don't agree with that. Then he brought my mom into it, which is the fucking worst thing he could have ever done. So he says, I bet your mom would be proud of this take. What a fucking scumbag she raised. So I simply posted this gangster pictures of me and my mom at dinner and basically said, when you were my age, you were a heroin addict. At my age, I bought my mom a house in Miami. I would say she's proud of me and glad I don't date girls with more bodies than a Call of Duty lobby. And then Twitter blew up. Like, I don't know if you saw this when it happened, but like, I've never had more replies to a tweet in my life. So he's like, oh, fuck. He's trying to like get back at me. He tweeted like three things and deleted them and then threw more up. So he says, homie, let's be honest. You pay half your measly net worth to sniff Lana's underwear. I know your type. Which immediately, and this is a lesson for everybody. And any, like, you're arguing with someone, you never get that personal because it means you're offended. Like, as soon as someone reacts, like, it's psychology. You're offended. So I was like, I got an ace up my sleeve if this dude wants to say that. So I posted, oh, fuck, I don't want the screenshot. Basically, I posted like the most beautiful picture of Brooke that I have. And I just replied to that with, nah, I'm good, G, and a picture of her. Bro, the replies from everyone else were like, common Luke W, holy fuck. Someone said, I saw 5 W's in 4 tweets. Like, just all kinds of love or whatever, because she's fucking like gorgeous. And I posted that picture and was like, oh, I'm good, G. And never in my life have I got more feedback, more DM. I had like 300 DM requests on Instagram of people just like, you fucked him up, good for you, fuck Mike Malak. Like, all of this. And he didn't reply after that, and then he deleted all of his tweets, but we screen recorded them. It's in my last YouTube video. It blew up. We actually have the whole thing, like, a reel playing because we screen recorded all the tweets. But yeah, basically it was a masterclass on how to handle an argument or an insult. You don't get personal because then you're offended. You don't want to ever be offended. You want to keep power and keep control of it and use like tactical precision and just dismantle somebody.
That was good. Where'd you learn that?
Nowhere, actually. I mean, kind of just principles of like the art of war. 48 Laws of Power, like stuff like that. probably where the first thoughts came from. But I'm just a very war-minded person, bro. Like I love to have enemies and I know it sounds really like cringy, but in a way I like that because then it's, I think very war-minded. Like I feel like if I was born thousands of years ago, I'd be in some sort of war position, but even business, it's not like a friendly game to me. It's war. Like there are consequences. So for him, like, okay, you bring my mom, which is like the most important thing to me in the world into this. I have a fucking obligation to destroy you now. And I did. And he put a sad face. I posted it on Instagram and he replied with a sad face to my Instagram. And he said, I have the DMs. I replied back to him and I was like, hey, I don't hate you. I just don't like agree with what you're spreading to like kids and promoting this stuff, whatever. Oh, did he block me?
Did he?
It won't let me click.
Yeah,
no way. No way. I hope he did. Let me see. Oh, no, he didn't block me. It just wouldn't let me reply. But him. I said, hey, I don't hate you, but the message that you're pushing is something I don't believe in, especially on this topic, and you got disrespectful. Have a good day, G. And he's like, that's all good. I know you got some followers off of it, LOL. So
yeah, he knows what it is. He knows the game.
Yeah, he knows the game.
Yeah.
And it worked well. But yeah, that was fun. It's a real problem, though.
What is?
I mean, like that video I made, it's such a big problem. Like Logan just came out yesterday. I quoted that one and it got like 1,000 likes. He's basically, or I mean, it's Mike and Logan two different times, but they're pushing things that are not good. And then they get like praise for those things. Like they put pedophiles and porn stars and just very immoral things on their platform. And that's what they use their platform to do and then squeeze money out of their people. They're not pushing anything good, you know? But then someone like Mr. T comes along and is like, hey, this is what masculinity is. This is how you should be a man. I come from dirt and look what I've amassed in my life. I donate a lot of money. Like, good person. Like, it's a good person. All the allegations, it's all bullshit. There is no, he didn't beat women. There's no assault. It's nothing like that, okay? If there was, I obviously don't agree with that. Like my mom got beat on. That's fucking terrible. Like I'd kill somebody if they did that. But like two narratives and two sides to that battle, and the side that is pushed and publicized is the side that should not be. It's like Mike is like dating a girl that publicly has had sex with hundreds of men and made money from that, and then wants to like use that as a flex. And then a lot of the guys in those replies supported him, which shocked me because I thought most people thought like us and we don't. Like we're the small minority, but a lot of them were like, oh, bro, that's fine. You can date whoever you want. You love who you want. No, dude, that's not something you should look up to. I don't know. It's a whole other problem. Like they're pushing things like that. Yeah, it's like someone in here just said, isn't that a subjective thing, Luke? No, it's not subjective because there is moral and there's immoral. There is no middle ground. Or subjective. I mean, some things are subjective, but it all leads to the same like road. You know what I mean? Like as soon as you start to push those things and OnlyFans, then you're pushing human trafficking and then you're pushing abuse on women. And then you're like, it just is a slippery slope and it continues to go down. And now look at our society where you have you seen this, Arlin? Like obviously it started with like the LGBT stuff and whatever. And listen, I'm not homophobic. If you want to be gay, you be gay. I don't give a fuck. I could care less. Like, I'm going to go hang out with these gay guys that she met that they're like modeling agency people. I don't care. But once all that slippery slope starts, now we have, and I see this on Twitter every day, there's people publicly trying to say that being a pedophile is a sexual orientation. Have you seen that? They call them MAPS, minor attracted persons. And the more leftist people are like, it's not a joke, bro. They're literally like trying to push it and put it in like schools and indoctrinate children and stuff. I swear to God.
Was just a minor attracted person.
Yes. That's pedophile. You're attracted to underage people. It's a sexual orientation. And I'm not like, again, obviously
Who are we to judge what's right and what's wrong? It's subjective if you want to touch little boys and girls.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying, dude, is like, oh, isn't it subjective? Okay, everything's fucking subjective. But at a certain point, as men, and this is what I think this is what we should have talked about or should talk about as well, Arlin. As men, it's our shot to call. Like, okay, where's the line? You got to draw the line somewhere, or that bitch just slides and slides further and further into insanity. And it's been happening since like I was born in 2000, right? Since 2000, we've had like Iraq war and Afghanistan, and then we've had 9/11, and then we've had just like all of these things have happened. And if you look at where we were in 2000, as far as morality versus where we're at right now, completely different world. It's black and white. Liberal in 2000 was like, oh, I slightly disagree with like your monetary policy. Okay, who cares? We're all like sane people. Liberal today on the far, far, far left is like, oh, I think pedophilia is okay, and I think every girl should have an OnlyFans, and it's empowering, and like all this shit. Like, why does it happen? It happens because no one draws a line, and there is no consequence, and it just continually spirals. So, I mean, I don't know. That's kind of a rant, but it's all the same stuff. And people are like, oh, you're overreacting. No, not overreacting, because watch what happens. Like, watch when this generation of girls that have OnlyFans and have children, like, what do you think Lana's son is going to deal with as a child, bro? How do you think he's going to turn out? And then maybe if he has kids, how do you think they're going to be raised? And it spirals. Like, behavior is passed down from generation to generation. So it's like, I don't know, dude. It's not good. So if your girlfriend starts an OnlyFans today, you will leave her. Fuck yeah, I will leave her. That is not happening, bro. No way. I don't know. What are your thoughts? Do you have the same views? I feel like you do.
Yeah. I mean, I would leave her if she started an OnlyFans. It's not happening. Yeah, I think
this guy in the chat is like his mind's being blown right now.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think it's a spiritual warfare. There's dark energy out there. There is. I was actually just in New York City and actually another Miami guy, you know, Kendall, you know, Kendall.
Oh, Kendall. Yeah, bro. Kendall's one of my really good friends.
Yeah. We actually met up in New York. He happened to be there at the same time. We just grabbed breakfast. Yeah. And we got deep on some, like, really fast. We got deep.
We talk about this stuff a lot. Yeah.
So you've probably talked about it, but he was telling me about like the whole Freemason movement and like the secret societies. And this is actually one of the notes I made to you was my Coachella dark energy experience. So I'll go to that in a bit, but Kendall was explaining how like a lot of the stuff that was happening on Epstein Island was not just map behavior. It like not just creepy guys, like, you know, preying on younger girls, but a lot of like this culty, high up, creepy dude as men get older, women get older thing is a strange thing that's happening where it's like, Kendall was talking about the whole Travis Scott thing and the human sacrifice of like,
it's real. It's so real. I 100% believe in it.
And it was the two things that are just creepy and scary is that he was elaborating on. I haven't done too much research on it, but so I wouldn't say I'm an expert on this, but that. And so, by the way, the people that are watching this video stream right now, don't quote me on this and do your own research. But this is just a topic that, you know, isn't talked about a lot. And I think actually does happen, but I can't verify because I haven't seen it with my own eyes. But I wouldn't imagine that it's that crazy where people, as they get old, you know, they lack energy. And what they do is they prey on young blood.
Adrenochrome, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. And they like take their blood and they take the adrenaline in their blood and they inject it into their blood because a child that is in fear has the highest level adrenochrome in their bloodstream. Mm-hmm. And so they scare the child, they take the adrenochrome and put it into their bloodstream. And that's like a lot of what the Epstein Island stuff was also doing, was like basically human sacrifice. The whole Travis Scott thing was allegedly a human sacrifice ritual. And they were like making human sacrifices to generate dark energy to fuel their movement further.
Yep.
You look at you, bro. Let's pull this up. You look at our boy. I told you long ago on the road.
Oh, dude, I don't even want to see anything from that guy. Yeah, it's disgusting.
Bro,
I saw the demonic thing, and I immediately was like, just, bro, like, why?
Like, apparently it's a, I don't know if it's a Freemason ritual, but it's a dark cult Illuminati ritual. Bro, I'm getting a weird ad right now, bro. I just, on all this stuff. Where is it? I'm pulling it up in the video. Let me share screen. How can you, like, okay, so this is part of, and I'll get into the Coachella experience in a minute, but how can you look at this and not think it's some demon worship thing? And how does this, hold on, where is it? Not this. Where is it? You know, it's not this video. It's the one where he's twerking on the devil.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Which song is that?
I just think, dude, like,
is it this one?
I don't know. So there's a lot of symbolism here. Like, if, like, literally just looking at that, that was a reference to, like, the Garden of Eden.
Oh, here it is.
Fallen angel, the Satan thing. Yeah, look, Garden of Eden. It's a snake. That's a tree. Yeah. Is there, that an apple in the tree?
He's Eve.
Forbidden fruit. Yeah.
Does he eat the apple? What's he doing? Yeah, I mean, bro, like, this is...
You live in the dark. You cannot pretend. Like,
like, what is happening here is not okay. And, bro, little kids are watching that.
That's the point. You know what?
Why
what
is that?
He
why is
viral with?
He canceled and that's not canceled.
Because what? It's very simple for everyone that is listening to this. They want you to see that. What they want you to see, you see. What they don't want you to see, they remove. They don't want you to see, like, a message like Mr. T. They want you to see that. Satanic, demonic, immoral, sinful. Like, they want you to see that, and you want that to be normalized. It's insane.
It's normalized, and everyone's chill with it. The top comment is, he went from riding the horse to riding the devil. Legend. What?
No sane person says that.
Why is that the top? Why is that okay? So I was at Coachella, and I was walking from, I think, a Big Sean set to a Solomon set, and Doja Cat was on, and I didn't really care to see Doja Cat. She was on the main stage,
yeah,
and I started filming, and I have it on my phone. I should really get it to show everyone. But, like, flames started coming out of the stage, and, like, this drum solo and this just, like, demonic noises started emerging from the speakers. And then I looked over, and there was a giant did you go to Coachella this year?
No, I've never been to anything like
that. Okay, it was my first time. So, so I look over, and I saw this, like, big statue or a big, like, probably like 50-foot thing that Coachella brought in, and it's like a devil thing. And I was just like, I'm looking around, me, the meditative dude I am, like, you know, I think you said in your video, like, you're, or maybe you said it earlier, I don't know, you're not religious, but you pray every day, right? Like, I'm the same.
I just don't like man-made religion. Like, I think Islam and Christianity are great things to live by. I just don't like the man-made, like Catholicism and that stuff. I think it's bullshit. That's what I mean by that.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, like, being the awake individual I am, I looked at this and I was just like, I just saw everyone around in a trance, in an unconscious NPC trance. And I was like, bro, this is like, this is the spiritual warfare. Like, this is a demonic dark energy on the stage, like, programming all these people and casting some kind of weird spell over them. Yeah. And I'm like, man, this shit's real. This is weird.
Weird. No, it's all real. And it sounds a little bit like Looney Tunes sometimes.
Yeah, it does.
But then you think about, like, what does that mean if this is all real? It means that there is the opposite that is real as well. like whether you want to call that God or whatever you want to call that, if there is, it's the yin and yang, like we showed me earlier. Literally everything in life is like that. Every single thing. Like, you can't find anything that is not yin and yang. There is light and dark. There is good and bad. There is so above, so below. Like, it's all the same. So if that stuff's real, the good also has to be real, which means there is like a legitimate battle going on. And I don't know what to do about it other than us, like us speaking out about this right now is great, but it's so far gone, dude. And people don't realize it. And they're so, I told her, Brooke, will you come here real fast? come here. So she did not know about this stuff.
Yeah.
At all. And then I showed her a picture. You know what the spirit cooking thing is? Like that agreement? You know what? Go pull up the screen share. Hey, come here. Do you remember your what? Yeah. What'd you say?
I got up so fast.
Oh, you got lightheaded? Do you remember, like, just so like people see your face?
Oh, this is Nas X, by the way. Is this? Oh, that.
Oh my gosh, bro.
Oh, word.
I need like a cross. But I told her, I was like, yo, they like cook and eat little kids, like all the like Hollywood elite people, like, and there's like pictures of it. She's like, no way. And I showed her, and she's like,
wait, tell me, what is this?
So look up spirit cooking. You have to look it up on DuckDuckGo probably, because Google will censor it, obviously. Yeah, Marina Abramovich. Look up images just right there on the right tab.
Her? Oh, I don't
okay,
like her.
I'm gonna blow,
Jay-Z,
I'm gonna,
bro?
Wait. I'm going to blow your fucking mind. Are you ready for this? Okay, you see a picture of her and Jay-Z? She is a known...
Dude, I don't like this, bro.
Just wait. She's a known Satanist, okay? So there's pictures of her and all these, like the Clintons, Lady Gaga, like all the elites, right? So she's a bad person. Very bad. They cook people. And they have, like, dinners where they cook people. There's pictures of it. Now go up to where you typed in spirit cooking. Type in her name, like copy and paste her name. Marina Abramovich. And now add Ukraine to the back of it. Okay, before you click it, are you ready for this? So obviously you've seen this already. It's kind of sketchy. And you know what's happening in Russia and Ukraine, like globally. People don't think this is all connected. Hit enter.
Oh.
Look at the wall. Click the wall right there with the crystals coming out of it. On the left, that's the first picture.
This one?
Yeah, that picture. Yeah. Bro, they just built this shit in Ukraine when the war started as a wall of crying commemorates Jews killed in a massacre. It's fucking crystals coming out of a dark black wall. Why is she the one doing this?
What? I'm going to have to do more research. This is weird.
Dude, you tell me. Click that picture of her holding the crystals.
Which one?
Like, yeah, right there. You tell me why this chick is in Ukraine while there's a war happening in Ukraine and people are dying. A war happening. Tell me why she is there building a wall with crystals coming out of it. And she's a well-known, like, Satanist.
So she's trying to, like, transmute the death energy or something?
It's something like that. But, like, you tell me this shit's not real when you see this. Like,
yeah, this
it's
is weird.
So in your face. Like, look, she's got a cross upside down on her neck right there.
Yeah.
Like, come on, dude. Like, come
she's
on.
Creepy, bro.
Yeah. It's real. It's all real. And it's nuts.
An attack on Ukraine is an attack on humanity and has to be stopped. Artist. She's an artist?
Artist.
Sends message of solidarity to Ukraine as Russia invades.
The same way Jeffrey Epstein was like a financial advisor.
Yeah, what's... Dude, I don't like that.
So you can find the picture I'm trying to show you. If you type in just her name and then like, I think add Lady Gaga to it, the picture might come up because they can't censor literally everything.
That doesn't... Lady Gaga doesn't look well.
Well. No, none of them look well. Oh, yeah, right there. See the bloody-looking legs? Click that.
No, where? Oh, this one?
Right there.
Oh,
so where? This one isn't an actual person they're eating, because obviously this is online or it would be deleted. But why would you have a dinner and why would you dress people up to look like they're being like cannibalized? Like, you don't do that just because, you know? Why it's is Lady Gaga standing there? This is real, like 100% real. That's not an actual person being eaten, because obviously they're not going to take a picture of that publicly, but it's real. Is that Lady Gaga and Joe Biden? It is.
Where?
Scroll back up, I think. Right there on stage, top left.
Oh.
Bro, it's in your face. It's so in your face. It's literally absurd. Like, it's laughable.
Huh.
And a journal just came out from Joe Biden's daughter saying that he used to take showers with her, like, inappropriately. And she wrote about it. And it was just confirmed as, like, it's real.
Who takes showers with who?
Joe Biden and his daughter.
Oh.
Swear to God. And then his son, like, you probably know about Hunter.
Yeah, like, I want to see someone defend this. Why is this okay? What's happening here? What is this?
Bro, Jay-Z and Beyonce are very well-known, like Illuminati people, like, pretty high up.
Yeah.
And it's all the same, you know?
Wasn't the Super Bowl, like, a thing? Like,
yep.
The Super Bowl performance devil worship. Yeah,
the weekend stuff is super sus too. Like, his shows, the sets on stage are that one, Katy Perry. They keep putting that eye. The eye is a thing. Yeah. Like, I probably sound nuts right now, but this shit's so real. Like,
well, I mean, it's just like, what is it like to play, bro? To play devil's advocate here, it's just art performance, and yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, dude. Do you know what Bohemian Grove is?
Yeah. That one, I don't know. That one, I mean, Rogan was talking about it.
No, it's real. Like, there's an actual video.
I know it's real. I know it's real, but they weren't burning a body. They were burning sticks. It wasn't like, it's just like people were meeting in the forest and they were doing some kind of like weird pagan religion.
Bro, it's our congressmen. And they go there and they do gay stuff together.
Oh, they do?
And they, I guess, I swear. And they burn an effigy of Moloch the owl.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
That's totally normal for our Christian congressmen to do together in the woods, in robes. And in the video that got released, you can hear like someone screaming when they lit it up. So I don't know if they burned people or what, but like.
All right, I'm going to. It's funny, devil's advocate. I never realized that was like a kind of a weird thing to say. But like, what about like just normal? Like you mentioned Christianity, like Christian. I was raised Jewish, so what do you call it? Christian preacher. I mean, if you didn't know what Christianity was and you saw like,
well, look, and yeah, look who they pop up. That guy is not a real Christian. Joel Osteen.
Oh yeah.
he's a false prophet. Like they're not what you should call a Christian. And then these guys are even worse, bro. Catholicism is a joke. Catholic Church is a business, and they like touch little boys, like, and it's not like a joke, dude. It's like, it's real. Like, they touch little boys.
I wonder if the touching little boys things is like a is like one of the, it actually probably is. It's like the adrenochrome thing.
Yeah. Because it's not like just a couple cases of like all of these like guys in this religion, just like little boys. It's rampant. Like, it's really bad. And they do weird. There's like there's some weird thing there with like a spider god.
Let's do this.
Oh, geez.
I actually never watched this. This is going to creep me out. Oh.
Come to think of it, they're actually.
Huh.
Someone said, Luke, you don't sound crazy. Thanks, guys. What in sweet Alabama?
I don't know. It's just like, when you see this stuff, what is your reaction? Okay, there's men chasing little boys through a field. And then, wait, what's happening here? Oh. Okay, so they're beating this guy. Oh.
That's Avicii, right?
Who?
The blonde guy.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, he supposedly killed himself.
Did he though? Or is it like one of those things where it's like,
I got no idea, to be honest.
What's he exposing here? What is this?
I think they might be killing like pedophiles.
Yeah.
Oh, so I think that's why this guy said that, because he killed himself. He was probably suicided because he was speaking out about it.
Right.
I think that's what they're saying.
Ugh.
Just like Epstein killed himself and McAfee killed himself. Yeah, that's exactly what's happening. It's human trafficking. Wow.
Huh. Oh.
So this was right before he passed.
Yeah.
Last song before he passed. Wow. That's ironic. They killed him because he tried to expose the sex trafficking market. Yeah, wow. That's what happens.
Huh.
It's pretty, dude, the rabbit hole goes and goes and goes and goes some more.
Bro, we're living in a horror movie right now. Yeah.
That's why it's so important that we like this whole point got brought up, because I was saying there's a line. You got to identify where that line is as a man, and you got to understand like morality versus immorality and good versus evil. It's a real thing. It's 100% real. And if you don't fight back, it just continues to spiral, and then eventually you can't fight back. It's real. How do you do research? DuckDuckGo, which is compromised now as well. Maybe Brave. I heard Brave or something else. You can't use Google because it's big tech. It's like censored. You got to have really based friends. I have some really good based friends on Twitter. Shout out Deja Ru 22. It's DejaRu22. He's very, very accurate with this. And then Drew Tang, DruTang. Both of those guys are really good information.
Yeah.
Follow them on Twitter.
Interesting stuff. Should we talk about something else, though?
Yeah, because I don't want to just be glooming. We can't really do shit about this, to be honest. That's why you just run up a bag and live independent of it.
Yeah. Word?
I don't know. I mean, what do you guys goated on Twitter for real, for real? Thank you, Layton. Let's just see if they want to hear, I guess.
Yeah, what do you think, chat?
Is my nice blue shades.
No, they're not my blue lights. Well, they are blue light, but they're for my Juve.
Juve.
Yeah.
This is called escaping the Matrix.
Yeah. I mean, I have thoughts on the Matrix. I think the Matrix is actually more so in your head. I mean, it definitely is. Like, it is in physical reality, but it's also in your head. I think that's one thing Mr. T doesn't talk about enough.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, you can have a lot of money and live independently of governments and such, and have multiple passports and all that. But if you are still stuck in your own mind, then that's an issue. You know, if you can't have peace, if you can't go a few moments without, like, you need to read some Eckhart Tolle to really escape the Matrix, is my point.
Yeah. Cause your own mind is a prison until you kind of control your own mind. Most people don't.
Yeah.
Non-physical.
David Icke. He's a guy that I got into, start of the pandemic. You know Brian Rose? You've definitely seen him. Brian Rose, he wears a suit. He has a show called The London Real. He's interviewed like Montauk Shea.
Yeah.
So he interviewed David Icke at the start of the pandemic, and this was like, David Icke is like a well-known conspiracy theorist.
Mm.
But he I kind of read the comments on the Avicii video before we move on. Why are they all in Spanish?
I mean, the comments I'm seeing have just been like agreeing with us. Not really questions.
I love the people realizing the truth. Thanks for exposing the truth. Save the children. All because he was about saving children and he ended up dead. He never killed himself.
So you guys should start your own war room. I would join. I have this little thing. We just started kind of like the war room, but I don't know. I don't really want to plug that one.
Plug it.
On Arlin's.
Plug it.
It is called Way of the Man. I have the domain wayoftheman.com, which is pretty dope. Arlin, I'll send you a link. You can join. It's basically, we're starting it off with just a Discord. We did one-on-one coaching, but realize it's kind of out of reach for a lot of people. So it's like a MRR type of like subscription model on Discord where basically we do this, but it's my business partner. His name's Temple Naylor. Do you know Temple?
No.
Really good guy you should connect with. He is some sort of high position for Cole Gordon. He's a stud. He comes from dirt, grew up in a trailer park, a lot of abuse, a lot of really fucked up shit, and he's top 1%. Like, you can look him up on Instagram. He's a G, really good friend of mine. No, it's not free. But it's cheap. It is very cheap. So it's basically a Discord and we're gonna teach you guys how to become top 1% men and think like this, because I don't want a bunch of sheep people around me. So it's like
how wayoftheman.com or,
yeah, let me see if that actually comes up.
It doesn't.
Put slash beta because it was for the beta group. Yeah, slash beta.
Oh, dope.
Yeah, that was just the landing page we threw together. But it's essentially our sole focus is help you to become top 1%. Like Arlen's top 1%. Like it's just guys like us, and we all have similar patterns. We all have similar beliefs, similar habits, and that's what makes you a man. So that video is fire. If they want to watch it.
Ah, sick.
Yeah. That's Temple.
Oh, dope.
What's up, baby?
You're hungry?
We'll go get we can go get sushi after this. We can go to dinner too. Yeah, you look good.
Damn, I love having a hot girlfriend. But no, it's cool. We're going to go hardcore on it because my one company obviously helps people make money. But I realized if I want to have a real impact, I can help you make money, but you're still limited like by yourself if you don't know how to think and you're not well-rounded. Like, who gives a fuck how rich you are if you can't walk down the street and defend yourself and your girl? Like, you don't know how to fight? That's why I've been fighting for a year, 3-4 times a week. And I pay someone to coach me like every day, you know? Like, I think as a man, there are basic standards you should be able to do. I think one of those is be able to fight. You should be in great shape. You should be healthy. You should be very knowledgeable about a lot of things, like we are talking about this right now. And then there's stuff that you can't really teach, and it's not flashy to sell in a course, which is discipline and sacrifice and having fucking morals and knowing how to draw that line. Because the reality is, being a man is not... it's not all sunshine and rainbows and Lambos and cool shit. Like, I post that stuff on Instagram, whatever, but like, that's not what makes me a man. It's not what makes you a man or makes us great men. You know, it's the intangibles. It's the hard work. It's not easy to get here. I was on fucking welfare 4 years ago. You think it's easy to get here? Hell no. But I have, and I can speak on that, you know? So that's what Way of the Man is. I'll be tweeting about it a lot. We're revamping it right now and structuring it even better. So yeah,
I like that. Yeah. I think more people should join those kind of things and more people should start them, because like, I have Tribe Accelerator, but Tribe is for guys who are already making, you know, really like 10K a month or more.
I really like that offer. Like, I've seen it on your Instagram. I think it's a great offer because a lot of dudes will start to make money and then they're like, okay, what now? Yeah, I just sit inside and work all day. Like,
exactly. So
that's a great idea.
But yeah, I mean, I would say my version of Way of the Man is Maxi, which is the other thing I talk about from time to time. But the whole ethos behind that is just learn how to program your own mind.
Yeah.
And I think most people who aren't, most men at least, who aren't at that 10K a month point, they don't know how to program themselves. So
yeah, 10K is so easy, guys. And I say that having struggled to reach it, and now do like 10 times that a month. It's so easy. And it's a lot of mind stuff. What? Brooke just looked at me and said, 10K is easy? Yes, it's very easy. You know what I make a month. Not really. I mean, it is what it is. How do you think I fly you to Greece first class? It's not with 10K a month. That's damn for sure. Oh, it's fucking funny. He probably already knows about Maxi since he stole the style. No. I mean, you think of a man, what color are you going to make a man? Blue? No. I'm going to make that shit red.
Is Maxi also red? Tribe Accelerator's red. Maxi's more blue. Have you seen my landing page for Maxi, by the way?
No. I think this guy was saying that I tried to steal your shit.
No, you definitely didn't, but I got to show it to you because I think you're going to love it.
How it is easy, just tell me without trying to sell me a course. Dude, okay, listen, since you have a bad mindset, I was making $30,000, $35,000, $40,000 a month before I had an education company. I did that with two different businesses. I did it with an agency, a marketing agency, and then I did it as a sales rep, a high-ticket closer. And then, obviously, that's what I built my education company around, is helping people do that. So, like, that's, bro, you talk about cope. We were talking about cope earlier. That's the biggest fucking most annoying cope I ever hear on the internet, having a personal brand. Oh, you sell a course. It's easy to make money. What you sell a course, bro. It doesn't, you don't get credit now. I have 11 employees. Like, I don't sell a course. I have an entire education company that if you don't succeed, it's my fault still, regardless. Like, it's, you don't just build a, people, Arlin, you probably get this all the time. People think you just build a course and you get rich. Fuck no. That shit's hard. I wish it was that easy. Like, it's hard. It's a great business model, but it's hard. So, like, yeah. Like this dude said, three words, high ticket sales. That's something everyone should get into. You should make something like Hustlers University with Arlin. I mean, that's Hustlers University is cool. Well, yeah. Way of the Man isn't strictly business. And I'm not against Hustlers University, but I don't want to build a product like that because I don't want to teach you or speak about business models that I haven't done personally. So I'm not going to teach you dropshipping when I'm not a dropshipper. I'm not going to teach you affiliate marketing when I'm not an affiliate marketer. I'll teach you sales. I could do an info product company program for sure. And I teach you how to be a 1% man. And so that's what I'm going to speak about.
Got it. This is the Maxi homepage.
Oh, it's clean. High CTR. Bro, yeah, that car, every time I see that car, it's like identical to mine. Like, I have the red brake calipers, same car.
It's a great car.
They're fun. They're very fun.
You
got a race car? Are you into cars? Because I know, like, E-Man doesn't give a fuck about cars. I know Seb, bro, I actually brought Seb to my mom's house down here. And she made us breakfast. Yeah. I know he has a sick R8. We talked about that. Do you like cars or you just not really care?
I love cars. I just haven't settled in a place long enough to buy one.
You're traveling all the time. There's no point in blowing money on it.
No, but honestly, I think it's coming up soon. I actually feel that the next place I get is going to be more of a long-term thing. And then I will do a car because I do like cars.
What kind of car guy are you? You a Porsche guy? You a Lambo guy? You a Ferrari guy? Or are you going to not go that level
yet? I was just attracted to the Aston Martin. I don't know if it's a James Bond thing. It's just subtle. It's like, it's not subtle, but it's like more low key than a Ferrari.
Those are great cars too, dude. They're V12s. They hold their value really well. I'd get like one that's been used like a couple thousand miles and car hack for sure. Instead of just buying a new one and then you're set. Good cars. Really good cars.
Chloe, What do you think is the biggest problem in the world? You said it to me on our first date.
I did.
Yeah. Starts with an F.
Brooke just said females.
What the fuck is on your face? Dude, come here.
Wait, hey, you want to introduce the girls in real time on live stream?
You want to meet Luke's girlfriend?
Come here. You're going to meet Chloe. Who cares? She probably isn't like that.
Oh, shit.
Look at the eye.
Hi.
Oh, wait. Hold on.
What is that?
Hi. Gel. Hi.
Why?
It makes
sure. Oh, shit, dude. Ew, it's slimy.
I don't know what that is. We're, hey, Chloe, it's nice to meet you. We're going to make you guys, like, become best friends.
Sounds good.
Okay, good.
I don't remember what I said, though.
Feminism.
Oh, I don't think that's the number one problem. I just think it's...
Arlin's capping for the live stream.
You think what?
I just think I don't like the word feminist.
Why?
Women's rights, but I don't like the whole, like, extremity behind the movement.
Well said.
Yeah, that's very wise. What do you think about feminism, Brooke? She said, I don't really know what that is.
Yeah.
Kendall's trying to get me to go out right now. Like, go out tonight.
Tell him to come on the stream. We're going to take over streams.
I am going to start doing this. You inspired me greatly today.
Yeah.
Because we can just be like, let loose. Like YouTube videos, dude, I got to be like, hey, welcome back, guys. Like, I got to be hardcore, like, to the point. I can't ramble or else you click away. You got to have, like, good metrics and shit. This, what are you doing?
It's a hangout.
Dancing. Oh, will you grab me one, actually? Yeah, like, will you hurry? I can't talk anymore without water in my mouth. Yeah, I think we should 100% do these. How good have you done them on? I mean, this is on YouTube.
Yeah.
How good does this help you grow?
Okay,
I see 70. Let me refresh it. 71 watching.
If you're good at it, it's definitely one of the best ways to grow. Because well, I mean, A, you are like, if you can retain. I mean, bro, Aiden Ross is retaining 100,000 concurrent viewers. We're at 73 right now. So we need to get our numbers up.
That is bananas, bro.
Yeah.
Damn. 100.
But for guys like us, like, we're recording for two and a half hours right now. We can take our video editor and cut this into a million clips for shorts and reels and everything. And we said a lot of good stuff on this where it's going to be controversial and controversial stuff blows up.
My creative director will chop this up and that's something you should do if you haven't yet, dude. Like, I know we run like the same businesses. I hired a creative director that is so fucking talented full time. I pay him like a lot of money, but it has been so beneficial and it's going to blow our shit up. And then we like have VAs under him. He manages everything. It's like a COO, but for creative. Cause like for our companies and honestly any business today, dude, it's fucking eyeballs and perception. Like
it is.
You and I could have the same exact product. My product could even be better than yours. But if my branding and my content and my perception is not good, you will smash me. So that was a good hire. Like, I don't know if you've done that yet, but that's a big one that I wish I did earlier.
I am basically training up a marketing creative head who's been crushing it. Like, my accounts have grown. My second Instagram account that I post all my reels on grew like 15,000 followers in the last month. So he's doing very well.
We should talk about that because some of mine are like hit or miss. Like, I started a new TikTok account, first video, 1.9 million views, and now all the other ones are like shadow banned or some shit. My Instagram, no. Someone's been deleting me all year too. Like, I've been getting attacked. I've been deleted like 4 times, and then all my alternative Instagrams, they get deleted. Someone's paying to take them down. So I don't know. I'll have a blue check. Like this month though, hopefully. So we'll see, but yeah. I'd love to talk about that stuff offline because we.
Yeah, I'll give away some. I'll give away some secrets. I'm sure we have some internet marketers right now. Here's the new funnel, or the new streamlined creative process that's going to make you a lot of money. You're going to have your reel editors make your reels. They have to be controversial because controversial things blow up.
Yep.
Take your most viral TikToks and reels and have another person on your team turn them into your tweets.
Yep. And then long form content like this produces all of that. It makes all the reels, it makes all the tweets, makes everything. What are you making? Toast. Nice.
But yeah, I would agree that's a great hire. I mean, I know that Iman has 17 full-time people on his creative marketing team, 22 accounts, and they're just, it's all in-house.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to hit 1 million subscribers this year on YouTube. He's going to have 300 million, I think, yearly views or views this year or something like that. I don't know.
That was the biggest thing I wish I would have done. Or honestly, I'd love to talk to you about that because I know you crush it on YouTube. I feel like my video quality is really good, especially as of late, but I just don't get a lot of eyeballs. And I'm not sure why that is. Twitter, I've mastered. I'll just be transparent with everybody. Like I was doing 6 figures a month on Twitter, organic, just like Twitter.
I remember you told me that. That actually opened my mind a lot.
Yeah, Twitter is the shit because people see your mind. It's not just flexing. But YouTube, I think my shit's great and I get a lot of feedback from it that is great, like market feedback, but it just doesn't pop as much as I would like. And I'm not sure why.
I'm looking at your YouTube right now. Now I'm just giving you a YouTube audit.
Yeah.
I mean, I think my first impression is how long have you been doing this? Not too long, dude. YouTube's competitive as fuck.
Three years.
Yeah, I know, but you have less than 100 videos.
Yeah. I mean, maybe I just don't understand like how the reality of it is, but I don't know. It's starting to pick up now, though. I will say that.
Oh, it is. It is.
Recently, it's been pew.
5K views on that video you posted 7 days ago.
So Seb shared that one on Twitter. He texted me, was like, hey, like this is a really good video, and he shared it and then it blew up.
Nice.
But I would love if you're free later, if you watch that Grease video. I feel like that is one of the best vlogs I've ever seen in my life. Like not just because it's mine, but the like issue ever. With
vlogs don't perform.
Vlogs is that why? Because dude, that thing has the best comments. It literally has like 3 comments saying, bro, this is the single best video I've ever seen in my life. And the watch time's great and the CTR is great. It's only got 3,000 views. So I'm like, what the fuck? I just don't understand.
Well, what's working right now is generalist self-development or business content. And then converting that into, and this is if you have, you know, a program. Okay, so one thing that I think could have been improved. Mm-hmm. Now we're just getting like a funnel advice. I'm sure people... some people got to be interested in this, but who cares? This is just fun. So I'll show you. The video was great. This is your Which Way Modern Man video. The thumbnail is amazing.
I made that one myself. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great. However, you send them off YouTube. The goal of YouTube is to keep people on YouTube. So you sending them to this website, YouTube doesn't like that. In the same way that if, you know, you're trying to promote like a different social media platform on Instagram, like Rumble, Instagram's immediately going to just shadow ban the word Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
So if I were to audit this, I've been on YouTube like 6 years, so I just picked this stuff
really up. So like putting links off of YouTube is actually bad. So yeah. You'd rather do that off of your social media.
Well, yeah, bro. Here's the secret. Look at Iman.
I was just about to ask, does he put links in his bio?
Yeah, he does. But look how he does it. So 17 side hustles you can start today. Same thing. 12-minute video. These are 17 top side hustles. Afterward, you might want to check this out. And this is a 38-minute VSL.
I'm writing this shit down. Where is my pen?
You're welcome. This will make you millions of dollars. Bro, if you're on YouTube right now, you can click to the stream that we're literally streaming right now. And what you're going to see is I'm not sending people off YouTube. I'm sending people to another video that I made that I think people would enjoy.
So you think put the like the VSL video, put links under that one, or maybe a link to send to a funnel to capture emails and everything, but the other videos just send more videos?
And the kind of VSL it is, it's a training. It's your free training.
I have a couple of those that are really good, so we could do that.
Yeah, post those on YouTube and then funnel traffic to that. But you might want to redo it because it has to be good. It has to have a lot of value. It has to be very entertaining. Mm-hmm. And people have to not, like, it doesn't have to, it shouldn't feel like a VSL, if that makes sense.
Yeah, they should feel so indebted because of the knowledge they got. They're like, fuck, I gotta check this out now.
Yeah.
That's sick. Well, thank you, sir.
Sharing,
I didn't know that.
I've been
in the YouTube. Seb gave me some good like content help that I changed, and it's been helping a lot, but I didn't know that.
Well, is there any other topics we should talk about to cap this off? Because I actually have a meeting at 6. I didn't realize we'd be going for like almost 3 hours. It's crazy.
I think we're good, to be honest. That's a while. I don't think people watched past this, so it might not, you know, make sense.
Well, people might be hopping on late.
True. Random question, but thoughts on escorts? What? Brooke's laughing. Dog, if you have to pay for pussy, my guy, you're not the man. You should get that shit for free.
What are your thoughts on escorts, Chloe? No comment.
Brooke. Same thing, no comment. Yeah, honestly, dude, I think this was fire. I think that's good enough for now. I'd love to do some more.
Let's get our network. Let's get
our... We have a lot of mutual friends, and this is the first time we've actually, like, spoken in depth about anything.
Yeah, and this is obviously dominating the internet right now. So let's get, like, us on a stream next week, and let's get couple of our other friends on a stream, and then let's talk about the same kind of stuff and push each other's offers and, you know, help people.
I'm down. And we have very complimentary offers too, which is good.
We do.
They don't compete at all. Yeah. Ooh, a little JV coming. The world's watching, watching some magic happen.
I love it. Okay. Have a great rest of your day, Luke. Enjoy dinner with Brooke. Yep. We'll have to connect our lady friends on Instagram. Absolutely. And I hope everyone else enjoyed. Subscribe to Luke. I put his channel link in the description.
Thank you, sir.
And we'll do this again soon.
Yeah, it was a pleasure. Thank you guys for hopping on. And Arlin, have a good rest of your day, bro.